When the final bell rings, there is only one place to go.
Wrestling Unwrapped.
To the max! Hello and welcome to Wrestling Unwrapped to the Max special. I don't know what number we're at right now. We are the Every Wrestling Fan Podcast, and we are brought to you by the W2M Network and in partnership with 41mania.com and Last Word on Sports.com. And we are doing Extreme Rules 2016 and Best of Super Juniors Night 1, because they decided to do Drop the Night 2 stuff right when we're about to start this, so... Night 2 and 3 tomorrow.
There you go. So I don't have to say anything, guys. Here, Sean gave you everything. But hey, I'm so happy to be here. Extreme Rules was a fun show to watch, and we are going to go through all the show, talk about every match on the card, give you our thoughts, everything involved, and man, do we have a great panel for you tonight. This is going to be a blast, and I hope you like the theme song. We had to do a special theme because it's been unfair to the guys at Wrestling Unwrapped that we've kind of had a W2M Central theme song. Well, now we finally fixed that. This is a combined theme. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Let's go ahead and run down this panel. I just mentioned Wrestling Unwrapped, so let's start with Mr. Patrick Ketza. Man, welcome back to the show. I mean, I'm excited.
Oh yeah, it's been a long 3 weeks since, you know, the last one that we did here, but yeah, it's great to be back as always.
And Mr. Harry Broadhurst, also from Wrestling Unwrapped, and of course the Raw Reaction. What's going on, Harry?
In what universe does Ketza get introduced first? I call shenanigans. Hey, guys.
Only Harry would care about himself enough to make sure he gets introduced first.
Yeah, don't worry. Of course. You're going to get plenty of love on the show, Harry.
I have to put myself over.
I know. You got to do it. Someone who doesn't have to put themselves over, and that's Mr. Tom Reese, the guy that knows all about New Japan, knows the whole history, the guy that I respect because he knows so much about the wrestling. What's going on, Tom?
I'm doing good. I'm watching the night two right now as we speak of the junior tournament.
So, you know, if Tom just has some great reaction, you know what's going on.
Exactly. So nothing else, you know, secretly is going on. It's wrestling he's doing, okay, people? If he gets really happy. So anyway, let's talk about the fact that, you know, my cohort...
Wow.
I'm glad it took Harry that long to figure that out.
You know me, Harry. But my cohorts and, you know, from Wrestling to the Max, Paul Leeser, what is going on, bro?
Surviving.
Making it. Still sick, but you are here. Thank
I'm
God.
I'm here.
And, of course, the guy who, of course, runs this thing, he is not only one of the best producers in the business, but he is Mr. Sean Garmer.
Well, yeah, that's me. I'm doing okay.
Doing okay? Yeah, see?
Wait,
see, you're supposed to
put yourself over,
Sean. My God.
I don't do that stuff. I'm good without that.
Well, good. I'm glad we all
have one person putting themselves over on this podcast was enough.
Exactly. And, of course, I'm your host, Mr. Gary Vaughn, and I am here to rock and roll this card. And so without any further ado, let's get this thing going, guys. Let's go ahead and start with the main event of Extreme Rules, Roman Reigns versus AJ Styles in an Extreme Rules match. And boy, did they, you know, go all throughout this arena tonight and really make a mess of everything. AJ went through, I think, 15 tables, I believe. It felt like that, at least. But so much happened in here. We had a pretty darn good match, man. I'm telling you. I just want to hear from each of you guys what you think, but I just want to say this before we go too far. We did have some interference at the end, which, you know, it makes sense for this storyline. In the end, Roman Reigns prevails, and at the very end here, after that takes place, we get Seth Rollins. He is back, and he is the man holding the title at the end of this show. A lot involved here, guys. I mean, Paul, to start this thing off, I mean, what was your thoughts watching this?
Jesus. A coming out party, maybe, for Reigns? I don't know if, like, AJ certainly worked his butt off to make Reigns look good. They worked a style of match that I think Roman is obscenely comfortable with. But God, he was impressive as hell in this. I really felt like he took his work to another level. This match was awesome. Match of the year worthy, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree. And Tom, you were kind of mentioning, you know, you were really impressed by AJ as well, just the way he handled himself in this match. I mean, I think both got a pretty good job in this match.
I think it's time for Rain to start getting a little bit of credit. I mean, it seems like the end thing to do with the bash on Roman Reigns, but it takes two to tangle, and while Styles was going to make sure that this match was great, Reigns was right there with him, and it's two straight months now. Great main events.
I agree. Harry, I mean, you were saying a lot. We were kind of talking about this pre-show, but you were not only just talking about this match, but even the ending of this match to you feels like it's very important. And what I mean by ending, I mean Seth Rollins.
Yeah, and the biggest thing about it to me here is, as you guys know, I watched the pay-per-view with a group of friends of mine. And the biggest thing that we were all talking about here is, regardless of the fact that AJ may have once again laid down for Reigns here, which most of us kind of expected going in, the thing you're talking about coming out of this pay-per-view is the performance that the two gentlemen put in, as well as the return of Seth freaking Rollins. And I'm really looking forward to seeing Seth and how they're going to reintegrate Seth into the main event here. And I think we're looking at a really killer main event for Extreme Rules, or not for Money in the Bank, excuse me.
Yeah, it seems like we got a great start here. And, you know, of course, the match itself was great. But, of course, Seth Rollins, I mean, this all does mean that Money in the Bank is right around the corner, because with Seth Rollins, you know he's that guy. Patrick, what was your thoughts watching this unfold?
I don't know what it is, but it seemed like AJ Styles and Roman Reigns bring out the absolute best in each other. You know, like Tom said, two straight months now that they've had phenomenal matches for the World Championship. And, you know, who really doesn't love the occasional cluster of a match, you know, because that's what this was, much like the second half of the last match that they had for the title. And, I mean, as far as Seth Rollins coming back with his badass new logo, I must say, you know, I'm hoping he can reclaim the belt, but we'll see how things go.
Yeah, I do love that logo. I'm totally on board with that. It is a pretty nice one. I have to agree. But Sean, I mean, watch. Go ahead. What are you going to say?
I was just going to say, can he please change the finish, though?
No. Yeah, me too. Yeah, I'm sorry. I know Triple H passed it on, but pedigree, I don't know.
Well, that tells me they still wanted to be heel Seth Rollins.
Which is all well and good, but at the same time, I want something more distinct that Seth can make his own. I hate the fact that they got rid of the curb stomp to begin with, because I understand the worrying about concussions and everything, but that move is given a grand total of zero concussions. But it's just, you got time to let Seth be his own man at some point, and hopefully if the rumored feud with Triple H does happen, then that's when he starts to develop his own finish once again.
Mm-hmm. I'm behind you 100% on that. I love the curb stomp, but it is what it is, I guess. Sean, I mean, round us out here. What was your thoughts on this?
I mean, this was freaking great. You know, as Paul said, match of the year contender, best match that both men have had, I think we can safely say, on a WWE roster. You know, obviously, you know, AJ's had better matches in other places, but I mean, this is right up there. And just insane what, you know, Reigns really, I thought he really shone in here. I think, but the most, you know, we give Reigns, I think sometimes people are just too caught up in this whole, oh, we want to bash on Reigns, we want to bash Reigns, and it kind of fogs you into that mind of, you don't want to say at least that, look, the dude has obviously gotten better, and wrestling was never the problem with Roman Reigns. You know, it may be other things that were the problem with Roman Reigns, but wrestling wasn't one of them. And obviously, certainly, you know, just like John Cena got better as he got older. And the same thing, Reigns is going to get better as time goes on, and he's still, you know, we'll have to see what happens when Reigns gets in a feud where he doesn't have a guy that obviously is one of the greatest out there. Can he be that guy that's learned enough to where he can start, say, you know, he has one of those other matches with Bray Wyatt again, and it looks a lot better than it has in the past, okay. But right now, you can only dance with who you got. And whoever he's dancing with has been awesome, and especially AJ. It's going to be interesting to see, because I didn't think necessarily that those matches that Rollins and Reigns had previously were that good, especially not to the level of the ones he's had with AJ. So it's going to be interesting to see if he has that same chemistry that he has with AJ with Rollins. But just some of the crazy spots they did here, I like the fact that each team got their time to interfere, but then they got out, and it was over. You know, we did get the Usos coming in and costing AJ that fall or whatever that kind of protects the Styles Clash a little bit. I hate the fact that we have to have him do two of them, and then, you know, Reigns only does one spear, but, I mean, it is what it is. It's kind of what they want to do with Reigns, so, you know. But, yeah, I mean, you really can't complain about that match, honestly.
Yeah.
I know there are people that are going to, and they are.
Oh, yeah.
Just because there's that fog of Reigns or whatever, but, you know.
Yeah. No, exactly. I totally agree. And, you know, there's a lot of great things to talk about in this match, and I totally agree with a lot of the comments you guys made. I'm just going to mention one thing that I thought was
somebody's phone. We can't have this the whole night. Somebody's phone, we're, like, repeating each other through.
Oh, yeah, I hear it,
so,
too.
I think he's on speaker.
Yeah,
you can't be on speaker.
No, it wasn't me. I'm asking who is.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah, I think we're good now. We don't hear
it
now.
Yeah, we're good now.
Really quickly, though, I just want to mention this. The match was good, and we got a lot of great things out of this, but I want to say this. The one thing I think that would really been cool, I know it's far-fetched. I know you guys can hate on me for this. I really wish they would have found a way to switch the set, the pre-show set that they went to in this match, and got a table in there that resembled the original table and broke the glass. Had, of course, prop glass, you know, sugar glass, something. I think that would have been neat to have, like, AJ thrown through it or something like that. I thought that would have been a really cool spot. But I get it. You know, you can't do everything, right?
Well, you know, the problem is, too, even if you have the fake glass, he could still get punctured or whatever, and then you have a situation where you got a guy bleeding, you got to stop the match and all that, whatever, and, you know.
Yeah, let's not forget that CZW uses sugar glass, and people still get cut pretty deep from that, too. So you're running a very large risk with the sugar glass. Plus, the other thing about keeping the glass the way that there was for the table that they used, it allowed AJ to spring off with that forearm, too, without having to worry about kind of any kind of excessive pressure being put on that.
Falling through or into that,
Yeah, so I think we got a caller on the line, don't we, Sean?
Yes.
May I do this one, please?
Yeah, go ahead, Harry.
All right. I mentioned to you guys when we were talking in the pre-show, this guy is actually a friend of mine, if this is the 201 number I was telling you about. Live at tonight's Extreme Rules pay-per-view, my buddy Anthony Murillo. Anthony, is that you?
Hey, what's up, man?
What's going on?
Not much. Just got back from the show. Unbelievable experience. A lot of good stuff going on. How are you guys doing?
Great, man. Glad to have you on. That's really cool that you got a chance to go, man. And kind of give us some ideas of how it was being there live and some of your favorite moments.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. A live show always plays out differently than what it is on TV. And obviously, I haven't had a chance to look at it on the network. But I will say that from the moment that I got there, when they showed Roman Reigns on one of the adverts on Titantron, he was being booed. And I have no idea how it was on the network, but in person, it was probably one of the loudest boos, round of boos, during his entrance that I've ever heard in my life. And I think that it's really curious to me that WWE is so insistent on making this guy their number one babyface when, to me, they have the easiest sort of problem on their hands is that Roman Reigns can be a top heel in the company and in all of wrestling, and AJ Styles can be the top face, not just in WWE, but in other wrestling. And everyone there seemingly was 100% for AJ. And a funny story was, my buddy of mine who I went with went into the bathroom, and there was a bunch of little kids who are the typical Roman Reigns fans, and one of his friends told him, "Hey, who are you rooting for tonight?" And he said, well, I guess I'm rooting for Roman Reigns. And he says, well, I'm thinking about rooting for AJ Styles. And they kind of admitted to themselves that AJ Styles was the better of the two. And when they left the bathroom, they were the biggest AJ Styles fans in the world and were quickly forgetting about Roman Reigns. So to me, as a fan who was there, it's just remarkable to see the WWE so insistent on, again, for probably the next 10, 15 years, taking a guy like Roman Reigns and shoving him down our throats the way they did with John Cena and insisting that he is their top babyface when, in fact, he is not. So that was relatively interesting.
Well, I'm kind of curious, Anthony. How were the reactions during the match itself for both Reigns and Styles? Because I definitely heard a lot of mixed chanting.
You know, I think that the fans, I think they realize that Roman Reigns isn't terrible. I think if you took Roman Reigns now and you put him in a match with John Cena circa 2006, I think that Roman Reigns is a lot more exciting. I think he's someone who has, like, the power moves, who can do the spear, who can do, you know, a lot of different style moves than John Cena did back then. And I think he would be the more entertaining to do. And I think he has a better look than what John Cena has or still has. He hasn't really changed his look. But I think that where I was sitting, at least, I would say that, like, about 80 to 90% were rooting for AJ Styles. And I did not hear many Roman Reigns. There was one spot he did, and I forgive me, it's a little blurred to me, where I think it was a power bomb of sorts. I think he did like a sit-out type of power bomb where the crowd chanted, "You still suck," which is, which quite frankly is an acknowledgement that what you just did was awesome, but we still hate you. So at least he had that for him, you know. At least he still had the, hey, you know, you still suck, but that was an awesome type of move. So other than that, from what I and when Seth Rollins came out, forget it. I mean, that was just pure. It was Seth Rollins' town. I didn't hear any boos. I didn't hear any disappointments. They were 100% behind Seth Rollins coming out and beating Roman Reigns up after the match.
Any other big reactions that you saw? Any other kind of notes that you would like to kind of talk about when it comes to their live crowd?
You know, it was interesting. After the show, I made my way down to the floor. I was not fortunate to sit on the floor, but I was a section above it, and I saw Noelle Foley, and everyone was asking for a selfie, and she gladly took one, which, you know, I think Noelle's going to end up being a big, big, big-time sort of prospect for WWE just because of her name and, you know, her last name, really, Foley. Other than that, I was surprised. I don't know, how to say that on the on the network, but I was really shocked that Baron Corbin seemed to get a pretty decent pop when his music hit. It seemed like everyone was somewhat happy to see him. The match was boring as heck. And speaking of boring as heck, I mean, I don't know what you guys thought of this, but I hated, with a capital H, that Asylum match between Jericho and Ambrose. I thought that was the most boring, stupid match on the card. I don't think anyone in the arena cared for it. I don't think anyone was particularly excited to see Dean Ambrose win. From where we were sitting, it was boring. And to be honest with you, I don't think I could tell you a very specific spot in that match that happened. It was boring, especially live. It was not what I think we had all thought it would be. Very boring live. And then the pre-show stuff, Big Cass got a huge pop, although people were disappointed with him, so. And, you know, that's really it in terms of, like, reactions. I think that, unless I'm forgetting something, I think everyone was behind Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, or Cesaro winning the title over Miz. I think they would have been happy with either one of those three guys. But it was a pretty typical WWE fan, New Jersey type of reaction. They were going to boo who they hated, which were the Usos. By the way, the Usos were probably the most hated team that I have ever seen at a live event. And I've been to plenty of live events. And I am telling you right now, I have never heard more disdain and disgust and just general volume of boos for a tag team than I heard for the Usos. They hated every single thing that they did. And aside from the little kids who are loud, they are loud. I can't tell you anyone that was specifically rooting for the Usos, which is something. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's interesting. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, coming out of the show there, your expectations given the reactions here, do you think it's possible that they'll take a look at the reactions to Seth Rollins' return tonight and think that maybe a double switch might be in the cards for this?
You know, I don't, and the reason I tell you that is because whenever you hear Vince or Stephanie or Triple H, that they listen to the crowd, I mean, it's very, you could tell that it's very contrarian to what they do, because if they listen to the crowd, then they would realize that there is some major money behind having Roman Reigns as a massive heel. I mean, could you imagine if Roman Reigns came out and told the fans to go you-know-where, and he had the Usos as his backup, and say he had a hot chick valet like Eva Marie doing a little fantasy booking? Can you imagine the type of heat that Roman Reigns would garner week in and week out? He would be probably the biggest heel in wrestling. And at the flip side of that, AJ Styles has given WWE something very tremendous in that he's bringing with him the allure of the Bullet Club. The WWE can't use the Bullet Club. They can't say we are the Bullet Club, but they can call them the Club, and they can damn sure insinuate what they are. And AJ Styles and the Club are the most popular thing in wrestling right now, more so the Bullet Club, the actual real Bullet Club. And instead of capitalizing on that popularity, instead of taking the ball and running with it, they're sort of presenting AJ as a quasi-heel while Anderson and Gallows are presented as heels. So, no, I don't think that they're going to look at Seth Rollins and say, wow, look at the response he got. Let's get a break. Nor do I think they should. They need heels. They need genuine heels right now. And I think that Seth Rollins as a heel is better as Seth Rollins as a face, even though he won't get that reaction, at least right now. But I think right now, long term, Seth Rollins is better off as a heel than he is as a face.
See, I agree with you that I think Seth Rollins is a better heel, but at the same time, right now, I don't think the reactions from the general WWE fan base are going to show that, because I think the vast majority of the crowd, especially since he's just coming back from what was a major injury back in November, he's going to get very heavily influenced babyface reactions right now, and I think that there might be some kind of possibility in them doing something down the road where a potential double switch could come into play. That's the reason I asked the question.
You know, for me, the double switch would be great. Obviously, I would be all for it, but I think that Vince McMahon, in his mind, he thinks that a reaction is better than no reaction, and Roman Reigns gets a reaction. And I think he sort of says to himself, if we have the face of the company consistently get a reaction, it's better than not getting any reaction at all. And I think him turning heel, I don't know what Vince thinks, because I think him turning heel would even get Roman a bigger reaction. But I think Vince is saying to himself, we'll just keep him as is. And, it's funny. I think we're in for another 10 years of what we have with John Cena, right? I mean, right now, it seems like John Cena is at least being more appreciated by fans. He's not around them. He's not around as often. He's been hurt. But also, we can kind of sort of see a little rock in him. He's doing the Hollywood thing. He's doing the Hollywood gig. And while I don't think he'll ever walk away fully, I think fans this last year, especially with that U.S. title series, are sort of accepting John Cena more. And while that's happening, I think we're getting ready for another decade of someone exactly like him, who is going to always win, who is always going to be a face, who's never going to turn heel, who at the most is going to be a tweener, not a good guy, not a bad guy, a MD guy. And that's it. I don't think it's ever going to be anything different. I think Vince has pegged Roman Reigns, the successor to the Cena throne, and I think that he is going to do what he has done the past, 10 years or so, and that's protect the king of the throne. And I think we're in for another decade of someone coming on and consistently winning and taking us on that. I think that's where we're headed.
Yeah, I think a lot of people would agree with you, totally. And it's a concern for hardcore wrestling fans, but, I mean, I think it's what you're going to have to deal with. It's WWE, and they do what they want. So, really quickly, I'd like to ask you two questions, because you were there live. The rest of this panel was not there live, so we're only judging by what we saw on the network. I think you've already given me one of the answers, but if you include the pre-show, what was the worst match?
Ooh, what was the worst match? See, I sort of agree with Dave Meltzer in the sense that the worst match doesn't necessarily have to be the worst technical match. You have to take the whole package. And to me, it was Ambrose versus Jericho in that cage match because it just nothing screamed fun about it. It was rather bland. It was rather boring. It was not extreme. It was not something that what I thought it would be. It wasn't telling that good of a story, at least live. So I would pick that to be the match where I really tune out the most.
Okay. What was your best match?
I thought the main event was the best match. I thought when you have a guy like Styles and a guy like Roman, you know, you put in the elements of Extreme Rules, and which is really an LBQ match, and you have Gallup Anderson and the Usos coming in. I thought it was easily the best match of the main so far. The four-way was a very close second. That might be the match of the night. I could argue either way. The four-way or the main event.
You're totally right on that. That's a big controversy right now. Fatal four-way versus main event. It's a big controversy. But, I mean, I totally see where you're coming from the main event purposes. And, and you saw it live. So, once again, you have a perspective we don't have the chance to have. And of course, you know, being there and seeing everything, you saw a lot of wrestling tonight, a lot of wrestlers. Out of all of them, who do you think deserves the MVP?
Wow, who deserves the MVP? You know, it's funny. I think, in a way, Seth Rollins does. I think, if we're talking about genuine reaction, genuine emotion, I think when he came out, and I don't understand why WWE didn't play his music. You know, he just kind of ran down the aisle, and it kind of took people, I think, a second to realize, oh, man, that's Seth Rollins. But when he came out and did what he did, I know I was running up and down the aisle, high-fiving random fans, going absolutely crazy, as were other people. So I think Seth Rollins returned in a lot of ways. I think he took that from being a pretty good show, I don't regret spending the money on it, too. Wow, that was a really fun show to go to. So I think I would have to give it to Seth Rollins. The guys in the four-way deserve it, too, I think. Even Roman and AJ. The thing with Roman, he's not bad. You know, he's not a bad guy, not a good guy. But he's not a bad sort of guy to have in the top spot. He's just sort of But he's pretty good, so.
Great. And so you're telling me that we got the network, so we saw Rollins standing with a title held above his head and it cut off. They never played any of his music. Did they just play Reigns' music they do at the end there?
It was funny. They played his music at the end. I guess from what you're telling me, I'm guessing it's after the show went off the air. They definitely played his music at the end. But then they also played AJ Styles' music when he was walking up the ramp.
Real quick.
Yeah, go ahead.
Real quick, it kind of ties into that. Did Rollins leave with the title?
Did Rollins leave with the title? I don't remember 100%. I don't think he did. I don't remember seeing him leave with it, but I could be 100% wrong on that. Because at that point in time, funny story, I was actually making my way down to the floor section, and I managed to get a selfie with Noelle Foley, and I grabbed one of those pay-per-view chairs, and I had to talk my way into getting one of those. So I was more focused on that than actually seeing Rollins have the belt, but I don't think he did. But if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. So.
Great, man. Well, man, you've given us a wealth of knowledge here, being there live, and it sounds like you had a great time, and We definitely appreciate you calling in, man. Anytime. We'd love to hear from you again, and this has been great. And Harry, why don't you give our friend here the proper goodbye?
When I found out that we were going to go live with the show here, Anthony lives in New York, and it's right across the state line over to Jersey for Newark for the Prudential Center there. And he told me that he was going to be live at the show, so I figured getting a live perspective for tonight's pay-per-view couldn't have been a bad idea. And I want to thank you, Anthony Murillo, everybody. Thanks for calling in, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you. And just real quick, this is not a plug for myself, but for something I think wrestling fans would enjoy. If you are in the New York, New Jersey area, June 11th, at Monroe, New Jersey, the Crown Plaza Hotel, will be Legends of the Ring 22. It's a big wrestling convention. Appearing is Sting, the Hardy Boys, Bret Hart, and a lot of other guys. It's always a good time, so if that's something that interests you as a fan, I will be there. So if you happen to be there, you can come say hi to me. I will be there for sure. It should be a fun time.
Awesome, man. Thanks. Go ahead, Harry.
I was just going to say, not to mention, Anthony has one of those jobs that even I'm jealous of.
Oh, man.
I get to babysit the WWE Network, so that's always fun.
Yeah, that is awesome. Yeah. Well, good. That's great stuff, man. We would definitely want to hear from you again. Don't be a stranger. You know, we'd love to hear from you.
Great. I will definitely call back in.
All right. Later, man.
Later. Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
All right, guys. Well, that was great. You know, it's always, like you said, Harry, great to have live perspective. I really love that. So, you know, hopefully we'll get more of that in the future shows here. Well, we're going to run down the rest of this card, and the way this is going to work, each of us is going to take a match from here on out, and I'm just going to roll quickly, kind of talk about my match, because it's going to take a very short amount of time. That way, if anybody else calls in, they get plenty of time. I got the first match of the night, the Texas Tornado match, of course, between the Club versus the Bloodline of, well, really just the Usos versus Gallows Anderson. This match was pretty much what you kind of expected, if you ask me. I really was sitting here thinking, okay, this may include something really great. I think really the best highlight is the end here with the bell being involved in the match and the Uso landing on it. And, of course, the pin 1-2-3. Nothing spectacular. Nothing that makes me just go, wow. Of course, with this feud, that's what we've seen. Nothing just wow, unless you're adding in AJ Styles or Roman Reigns. So, but, of course, Gallows and Anderson do get the victory here. I'm thrilled about that because they've been made to look dumb at times. I'm just going to be honest. They've been made to look pretty bad against Roman Reigns and the Usos even. So I'm glad they got the victory. That gives them a little bit of a nudge, if you ask me. So from there, go ahead.
With what happened in the tag team title match, do you think this sets up the Club, as they're calling them, for a potential run at the New Day?
That's a good question. You know, down the line maybe, but right now, I don't think storyline purposes is going to allow that right now. But yes, down the line, I do think that's going to happen. So, did anybody else have a differing opinion with me on this match? Because I really was not, you know, thrilled. I just kind of sat there, to be honest with you guys.
The thing I liked most about this match was that they actually made Gallus and Anderson look relatively dangerous throughout the whole thing. I mean, the Usos certainly got their spots in, but I think it was more about showing off what Gallus and Anderson can do together. I really appreciated that, and that's what I took away from this, was them finally at least getting something behind Gallus and Anderson to where you might want to care about them.
Yeah, to what Paul was just saying there, I think the most important thing to come out of this is we're finally starting to see some variety in the offense for both Doc Gallows and the Machine Gun. It's,
I don't know what you're talking about. Anderson still didn't do anything, but, you know.
I hope you're not expecting him to actually use the gun stun in the WWE, because that's not happening.
I'm not saying he should, but, you know, at some point, he already knew they weren't going to let him use the gun stun. I don't think that, you know, WWE's really doing him any favors by...
Hell, I'm shocked they're letting him use the magic killer.
Yeah.
What's wrong with the magic killer?
I could have sworn originally they said that they didn't want Gallows and Anderson to use the magic killer for some stupid reason.
They did it the first night they were there.
Yeah, and then they didn't do it again for a while. And then
they didn't do it again for a week.
Wasn't there a news bit, though, saying that they didn't want him to use the magic killer because they didn't want to use the killer term? Same with why they renamed AJ Submission.
Yeah.
I think that was the stupid reason Ketza was talking about.
They took it away for like 2 weeks, I think. Then they brought it back, and then they stopped using it because they weren't winning matches. And they do the stupid Boot of Doom. Seriously, come on. We come up with a better name.
2 weeks is half the run right now, so.
See, I might be in the minority here, but I actually like that Boot of Doom as a tag finish.
I completely agree with you on that, Harry.
Yeah, and everybody, that's Mr. Glenn Smith. Welcome to the show, man.
We have two callers on right now because Mr. Rick Balon is on here as well.
Hey, Rick, what's going on?
What's up? What's up, Glenn?
Hey, how you going?
It's caller overload.
I know.
God, the people listening are probably like pitchforks right now.
Yeah, they. Well, you know, it's great to have everybody, you know, back on the show. And, of course, you know, Glenn's a regular caller, and so is Rick. I mean, Rick always does a great job calling in on these shows, and I really appreciate it. So let's go ahead and start with you first, Rick, because I have a lot of questions about this main event, of course, about the entire show in general. What was your thoughts, though? What was your favorite part? Was the main event your favorite part, like a lot of people are kind of saying, or was it the Fatal 4-Way?
The main event was great, but the Fatal 4-Way blew it out the water. That was match of the year candidate right there. That was the best match of the night, in my opinion.
Hey, fair enough. It's a controversy. The caller before just said that he loved the main event. Glenn, what would you say? What was yours?
If we were talking about favorite moments, just kind of moments that just shocked the crap out of me, obviously, like, just because it hasn't been done in nearly 10 years, the barbed wire, Dean Ambrose getting hit with it, and also the fact that they brought out thumbtacks. I was, like, completely shocked that, like I know Sean was posting, like, in the thread saying, like, it's a long con, but my God, what a payoff. I mean, I never thought I would ever get to see a thumbtack or a barbed wire spot ever again in WWE. I just thought, like, that was just so neat that they actually allowed that.
Yeah, I totally agree. It's kind of neat that they finally brought that back. But, you know, as we talk about this, so you guys kind of give me some of your favorite, you know, your match and the moments and all that kind of stuff. We've had a little bit more controversy in this show about, like, the worst thing you saw the night. It could be a, you know, a moment, or it can be a match. I mean, Rick, what would you say out of this whole thing?
I'd say that they still cannot book a proper ending to the Divas Championship matches. I thought that was horrible with Dana Brooke coming out, and I don't mind Dana Brooke siding with Charlotte or any of that, but why would Natty let go of the hold? Just because Ric Flair's music came on. She had the sharpshooter locked in. She just had to hold it there to make Charlotte tap. But she let go. She lets go the hold to watch a fake imposter Ric Flair walked to the ring, which happened to be Dana Brooke. It's retarded. It's stupid.
But Rick, everybody does that. Everybody. The music is the thing that stops you in your tracks. Like, just,
yes.
It don't matter.
Exactly what Sean said. Apparently, Nemesis music hitting is Babyface 101 to turn into a gigantic moron.
Well, I mean to be,
any
to
other day I would give it to you, but the stip was if Flair came out, she'd win the belt. So she could let go,
yeah.
And if it was Rick, yeah. She would have won the belt.
And to be fair, too, the referee freaking stopped doing what they're doing. Everybody stops doing what they're doing when somebody's music hits. It's like, oh, my God, this is happening.
Is somebody actually covering the women's match when we get into our breakdown of the show? Because if so, I'll save this for then.
Yes, we do have someone breaking that down.
Okay, then I'll save my thought process on this match until then.
Okay, but I just want to say one thing. I mean, to this whole process of wrestlers always being distracted, music or anything, I think that WWE's wellness policy definitely needs to be changed, because Adam Rose has already taken the medication to help him with that. Why isn't everybody else taking it?
Oh my God. Scary.
So, anyway.
Wow.
I'm sorry, but that's funny.
Okay, so anyway, I'm taking up time.
Man.
I don't need to take up time.
Oh, for everyone.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, so, too far, man. Too far.
Yeah, way too far, Glenn. I agree. Rick.
So when the guy loses his job eventually, we'll have Gary to blame.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. But Glenn, I mean, I want to hear your real quick. You know, the thing you think was the least impressive on this show.
Yeah. I will say I'm pretty much going to be in total agreement with Rick over here, saying that is just so stupid. But out of all the people that that would be dressed up like Rick, she was not even on my list. I honestly thought it was going to be Lil Nate coming out there. Worst case scenario,
I didn't think so when they dropped that thing really quick.
Glenn actually took my line of thinking there. If anybody was going to come out dressed as Rick, I was really expecting it to be her brother David.
Oh, seriously? They're not letting David Flair anywhere near, other than in the Hall of Fame ceremony, anywhere near WWE TV.
Okay, to be fair, they'd be smart to keep David Flair away from catering. That being said, storyline-wise, it makes sense.
Nah.
I mean,
Dana Brooke makes a lot of sense from she helps. Natty can whip her into ring shape, and she's good on the microphone, so she'll be able to hold her end that way. And, you know, puts Dana in a program where she can learn.
Yeah.
It's good.
Well, Emma getting hurt kind of needs to change up Dana's role, too. So I guess I see where it's coming
but
from.
But they both would be in that program together because that's how that always worked. Dana would have matches with the same person Emma was having matches with. It's the same.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Charlotte is the new Emma for Dana, basically, since Emma got hurt.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
I think that's
better than the rumored Eva Marie pairing.
I think that's
Lord.
It's not necessarily a pairing. I think it's more a just Dana's just having to be the person doing it that night, just like Little Nate, and it'll branch off into Dana and Natty, and it won't be about Charlotte anymore.
We'll talk more about the women's match in a little bit here, but let's go ahead and give each of these guys just a couple minutes here to kind of give their thoughts on this night. You know, we have a big show still. We haven't even got through even half of the show yet. So let's go ahead and start. Glenn, just give us a couple minutes of your thoughts, you know, what you think about the show, just really quickly. Just go ahead, whatever you want to say.
I was really disappointed, the placement of the no DQ match between Corbin and Dolph Ziggler. I think they could have put them with at the Dudley Boys segment instead of and have Dudley Boys and Big Cass and them close out the pre-show. That way they could have given them more time so they could have had a better match. I think that was probably one of the more painful finishes of the evening. I will have to say, I think it's called Extreme Rules for a reason. I was a little bit disappointed by the fact that the U.S. title match was a normal match. I mean, it is Extreme Rules for a reason. Like, aren't all the matches supposed to have like some sort of no DQ based part?
At one point they did. Over the course of the last couple of years, they've kind of gotten away from that, Glenn.
Well, it's kind of stupid. I mean, you call
I kind of agree
rules.
With Glenn, too. That's stupid. Just make it an entire no DQ, no count out show.
In the original premise when they started doing like the gimmick pay-per-views and the stipulation pay-per-views was only the main events. That was the original premise, was only the main events would actually fit under the title of the pay-per-view.
Mm-hmm.
So, not to mention,
well, then we have that one Hell in a Cell show. Wasn't it the first Hell in a Cell show where it was all of them were in a Hell in a Cell?
No. It was three matches.
Oh, okay.
The heavyweight title, WWE title, and then DX and the Legacy.
Yeah, WWE's never gone full lockdown on us.
That would
Thank
be
God.
Kind of... I have to say, if it's called...
They locked us down in sleep, is what they did.
Well, if they call it the match the Asylum match, I mean, it's supposed to be no escapes, pinfalls, submissions. Shouldn't the roof, like, there be an actual roof that can contain them so there is zero escapes?
Yep, that's what Lethal Lockdown was.
And I think the fact that is what Lethal Lockdown was is the exact reason there wasn't a roof, because they would be starting with the possibility of a lawsuit.
What?
Not necessarily.
Give me a break, Harry. Not, there's no lawsuits in wrestling matches.
Well, not necessarily.
Yes, there are.
No, there's not.
Well, don't forget.
You
that
call it something else. It's no longer the same match.
Yeah, he's got.
Is that why? Is that why TNA has to call their TLC matches Full Metal Mayhem?
Yes, indeed. Exactly.
The way to solve this whole issue about the no ceiling on this cage, you just take a page out of WCW's book. Have guys on the top of the cage with cattle prods.
What?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God. I that is just way before me. All right, I need to know where.
Did you really just drop a David Arquette reference?
I had to throw something.
Gary
in there,
always has no problem dropping David Arquette references.
Oh my
Gary's
God.
Script is just, when in doubt, use David Arquette reference.
Yes.
Gary, you're fired.
How does anybody even remember that?
I'm sorry. I apologize. All right.
You should.
You woke Tom out of the watching the Super Juniors to tell you that, Gary. You got a problem.
Yes, you pissed Tom off enough that he's actually paying attention again. How dare you?
Oh, boy. That's
Speaking
awesome.
Speaking of said Super Juniors, did you guys hear that I think it's June 6th and June 7th. Those days are going to be with English commentary.
Well, good for Gary.
Hey, if Matt Striker's on, I will watch it. If
not,
no,
nope, thank God.
Nope, it's,
thank God.
It's good old Steve Corino.
Yeah, I'm not watching it then. If Striker's on, I will.
Corino is way better than Striker.
I disagree.
Oh, buddy.
Striker works in. Striker works in one location in Lucha Underground, and that's it.
I like both Striker and Corino as color commentators, so I really can't complain either way.
Do you have a commentator you don't like? Jeez.
Bill Dundee?
Yes. His name is Bradshaw. What's your point?
Yeah.
That
yeah,
one doesn't
exactly.
count. Who likes Bradshaw?
People from Texas.
And I think people from Texas at this point don't like him either.
I don't really care for Josh Matthews either, but that's beside the point.
Oh, yeah, he's the worst.
Oh, God.
He's universal shit.
I don't know how AAA decided to sign him up for that World Cup. I am not watching it just for him.
Oh, boy.
Or so I watch it on mute instead.
Yes,
or
exercise.
Even better, just watch it with the Spanish commentary.
That's true.
Yeah.
Damn it, I forgot it.
All right, well, We've not only alienated Tom to this whole conversation, but we've also alienated Rick. So, Glenn, I want to give you, let you just one last thought you want to say, and then we'll let you go, man.
They didn't properly use the son of a Mitch.
Ah,
that's right. They did. They left the plant there. Huh.
That they needed that to be the final weapon to be used.
I agree.
Have Ambrose do the dirty deeds on it. Stick it, or even better, stick it, Jericho's head inside said potted plant. Dirty deeds then, or just
wouldn't
forego
Ambrose be the one to like
it.
Save the plant?
Well, I mean, come on, smash
no, it's
stuff.
If Mitch Senior had to die, Mitch Junior should have died for the cause as well.
Mm-hmm. And just what keep on. Just remember this. Now you're messing with a son of a Mitch.
Thank you for that, Glenn.
He waited the entire time to say that.
Yeah,
that
you
oh,
did.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Well, Glenn, man, it's been awesome having you on once again, man. Thank you for calling in and giving us your thoughts, buddy.
Adios.
Later. All right, Rick, I apologize. I know we've gotten to these crazy talks about announcers and things that are not Extreme Rules. Give us some of your thoughts, man. Anything you wanted to talk about tonight?
Oh, yeah. And not alienated at all. It's great to hear Glenn. I think it's pretty cool that, you know, we all kind of know each other because of the Wrestling to the Max group page on Facebook. And I actually became friends with Glenn on my personal Facebook page. So this is a really cool wrestling community. It's a little plug for your own group right there.
Oh, thanks. The Yes Network, both of them, you know, the Yes page and the WN2M page are awesome pages to go to.
Yes, yes.
Especially when we don't
Glenn's
have,
right.
Especially when we don't have breaking wrestling news, just plastering that Yes page all the time. Thank God.
It was how you really feel, Sean.
it's a bunch of bullshit, but we'll go on.
Let Rick talk, for God's sakes.
You can get me in trouble, man. My higher ups. Anyway, I think Glenn has a point that he made about the son of a Mitch not being used. And that crowd, they were even chanting for the Mitch plant, which is sad because I think that plant was more over than either Jericho or Ambrose in that match. And I can't believe they never got to it to use it. I kind of agreed with y'all first caller who was there live. That match didn't really do it for me, and it should have. I mean, I thought it was kind of funny that it was a cage match filled with weapons, which was essentially used as a cool-down match for the awesome four-way that was right before it. And maybe that's why it never gained traction, because people were still on a high from the four-way match. It's hard to get into another exciting match right away. That's why you put cool-down matches on your card. But this match, like, the thumbtacks were cool visual, but it didn't work for me either. I thought it was kind of boring, which is sad that a hardcore match with lots of weapons can actually bore you.
Yeah.
I think this match did more to help Ambrose than any of the matches against any of the previous matches he's had this year did to help him, though. The one thing I did want to ask you, Rick, since we didn't get a chance to do this with Glenn, what was your score for tonight's show?
I gave it a 7. I voted 7 on the page as well. I don't know. I could probably go a little bit higher. I thought the entire pay-per-view was good. They had two really good matches, the main event and the four-way. Nothing that really stood out as horrible. I didn't catch the pre-show, and I usually don't count the pre-show whenever I'm evaluating the pay-per-views itself. I know y'all tend to, but I don't. But overall, it was pretty good. It was a good pay-per-view.
Yeah, I mean, anything that you found super interesting out of this whole thing? I mean, I know you kind of touched on a little bit, but anything from the main event, anything you wanted to kind of touch on?
Oh, wait, so am I the only one that felt like during Reigns' intro, you could obviously hear that they cut the mic down?
Oh, yeah, it's definite. You can tell.
I was sitting there having an argument with somebody. I was like, it's obvious that they were booing the moment his music hits. The mic goes way down. You can't hear anything. You're going to tell me somebody didn't hit the mute button?
They were booing before his music hit, after AJ's music hit pretty much.
I know, but his music's not that loud. You could have been able to hear the boos just as audibly during his entrance.
Well, the boos were pretty loud when Lillian did her introduction, too.
Well, that's what I'm saying. For some reason, during the entrance, they cut him down. They cut that. They put it on mute.
My wife's your quintessential casual wrestling fan. She doesn't really follow it that closely, but she watches it because it's on in the house. And she made a comment like, man, I knew they didn't really like Reigns, but I didn't know they hated him that much. So that goes to show you, like, it was very noticeable, the crowd reaction he got tonight.
Yeah, I mean, that proves a point right there. I agree. You know, anytime someone pops in and doesn't watch the product on a normal basis and has a comment to say, I'm always interested. And I think you've got a good point here. It's wild. It really is. The way the WWE's handling this whole situation, I mean, it's like Sean said, I mean, they're obviously turning the mics down. They've been playing the music louder at times. Sean, me and you, right there at WrestleMania, Monday Night Raw, the night after. How loud was that Reigns music compared to everybody else's music? It was blaring. I mean, my God. So it was to drown out all the boos. Yeah, so.
Didn't help in Reigns' case for Raw, though, at Raw, because I was there, too.
Were there. Yeah. So. It's crazy, but Rick, anything last things you wanted to say before you get out of here?
Just that in the four way, man. I love that they're keeping the Zayn Owens feud really hot, like they should. And I love the fact that Zayn's had that title in his hand. Like he had the victory, he could smell it, and it was Owens that cost him the victory, which set Zayn off.
And that was great because you would normally you would think it would happen the other way around, that Owens would be so close to winning and Zayn would just foil him. But I like that it happened this way because now it shows that Zayn isn't just there to be a thorn in Owens' side. He's not just there because him and Owens are enemies. He's there because he wants that title too. And it puts more importance on the Intercontinental Championship belt as well. So you got people that just, they want this title badly. These mid-card awesome athletes are going after this mid-card title, and it's elevating the importance of that title up. And I really appreciated that.
Yeah, for sure. I totally understand where you're coming from on that. So, you know, a lot of good stuff tonight.
As apparently my internet's coming slowly back on, we're back live, looks like. Okay, so now I can add everybody back in. I don't know why this has to be a normal thing every time we do a podcast now. This is great. But anyway, moving on to the next thing that we got to do here. I don't know why it's only calling one person, but now all the calls are failing. That's wonderful. This is not good. Okay, so we're... Oh, jeez. Hello?
Are we back?
Yeah, my internet connection went out.
That's cool.
Hold on, you're going to have to call again because I can't call you. I can't add people to a call. Oh, no, yeah, I can. Never mind. Oh, well.
So I'm good?
Somehow Gary got knocked off, too. Let me see if Paul's still there. Yeah.
Patrick got knocked out as well, so you're going to have to message Patrick and tell him to call back in.
Okay, I don't know why. This is weird. It happens to Gary all the time, too. He gets knocked off.
Is Rick still here?
No, we'll just have to go on with it. Yeah, let me call Patrick so we can... my internet decided to go out again, Paul, so...
I figured. We're still live on speaker, too, by the way.
Yeah, it disconnects us, then shuts that episode off. Then it restarts it again. So I have
fun.
Hold on. Okay, so we've only talked about the main event and the pre-show match, right?
The opening tag. We hadn't talked about
and pre-show. The opening tag. The pre-show match was what it was, but I guess if you want to elaborate on it, one of you guys? I mean,
yeah,
I didn't think much of anything of it.
It wasn't anything special. Baron Corbin takes on Dolph Ziggler, no disqualification match. Corbin goes over, which is the correct move, because obviously they still have to capitalize on him winning the Andre the Giant trophy, and this feud I think has really done nothing for him other than keep him on television, which may be all they're after right now. But other than hitting a really nice-looking deep six and the overly aggressive low blow, I would say. nothing too special.
Okay, Gary.
My biggest...
Go ahead, Harry.
Resume your duties.
I was just going to say, my biggest concern with Corbin is for as good of a bumper as Ziggler is, if Ziggler isn't making the matches with Corbin entertaining, what hope does the rest of the roster really have with a guy like Corbin? Because he doesn't mesh with a lot of particular styles.
I think it's also people just don't care about Dolph that much anymore either.
I think Dolph isn't probably super happy with where he's at anymore either. He very much feels like he's going through the motions.
Again.
Yeah.
It's just my problem was this was a one-spot match. The entire point of the no disqualification stipulation that was added was pretty much simply for the low ball. That's it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
With as many weapons that were used throughout the rest of the night, though, I'm okay with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that the pre-show, you should have had him use something. Because this is the thing people are watching on YouTube and whatever.
Yeah, I mean, obviously you don't give the whole cow away, but you do something, I think, a little more than what we got here.
Actually, no, I think the people only watch the, they only get the first 30 minutes on YouTube and that stuff, so I think they only got to see the big cast and Dudley Boys thing. Never mind.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's the pre-show, so
which,
I don't
that
really
was weird. They did say that Enzo was backstage, so maybe they're holding him out for tomorrow. Since they already had Seth coming back, they didn't want two returns.
But didn't you find him interesting? I mean, I thought they were going to put up, like, let's just say Kaz was out there. I thought Enzo was going to run out, put up a table, and step back, and then Kaz was going to use it.
Yeah, or they just have Enzo come out so they could tell everybody that Enzo's okay or something. Just, you know.
Yeah, I think this would have worked. I think this would have worked better if the Dudleys had interrupted Big Cass rather than Cass coming out to interrupt the Dudleys.
I think it works that way because you don't have a reason for Big Cass just to randomly come out unless Enzo comes out with him. Then you can do that because it's sort of a celebration type of thing.
Well, you could have him tease the return of Enzo. Like, he could come out to the ring by himself. He could announce that Enzo's about to come back. And instead of his music hitting again, the Dudley Boys' music hits and they get into it there. It could work.
Yeah,
I thought it was fine still because you only had the Dudleys running down Jersey and you got nobody else in the back who's going to defend Jersey but Cass and Enzo. So, I mean.
Yeah.
Very true. Well, all right, enough about the pre-show. Let's jump into something else that we haven't really talked about. And, of course, that is the U.S. title match that they had tonight. And, of course, Kalisto faced off against Rusev. And, you know, it all went down, Harry, but what did you think with Rusev being the new United States champion?
I'm actually perfectly okay with this for a multitude of reasons, and I'll explain a couple of them real quick here. The first and foremost reason that I'm perfectly okay with this is the fact that honestly, Rusev is much more interesting now than he was when his original run as the U.S. champion when he's undefeated, because his character has a little bit more of a sense of vulnerability to it that it didn't have back then. Second of all, well, let's be perfectly honest here. He got like a complete and total douche to Kalisto tonight, and it stood out in a way that we just haven't seen that kind of fire from Rusev in so long that it was entertaining to see him like that tonight. Third of all, I think the time was right to get the U.S. title off of Kalisto. And the reason I say that is because Kalisto has not been the focus in any of his U.S. title matches because they've all been thrown on the pre-show or they've all been just kind of scattershot it with everything going on with Ryback. Rusev is somebody that has enough heat and has enough of a fan following, both those who like him and those who don't like him. So I very distinctly heard a "Let's go Rusev, Rusev sucks" chant tonight. So I think there are enough people behind Rusev that he's going to get babyface reactions even as a heel, but there are still going to be plenty of people who don't like Rusev for the xenophobic anti-American character that he's playing.
I would agree with you, but you got to remember this is a uber smart crowd. So
I agree with your point. I think it was time to move the belt. The WWE clearly wasn't going to do anything more with Kalisto than what they already were. I think it's a fault of their own, because they could have made that Ryback feud, I think, into something more than what we got, but they just never really... Kalisto's feuds were always the afternote of everything. It was always the one match, hey, here, it's still here, and then we're moving on to something else, you know, so... Hopefully with Rusev, you can get that belt doing some more. I think you're right. People do care more about Rusev, even after the abomination that was the League of Nations stable. So hopefully this is the first step on the right way to getting Rusev back towards the top of the card.
Real quick, two things. One, talk about Rusev, because he did the social media stuff before the show, or during the pre-show. That may have been... funniest social media wild stage that they've done yet.
I love Lana doing it personally.
I do want to give Lana. Okay, I'm getting an echo.
Me too.
Yeah. I do want to give Lana credit real quick here.
the comment that she had about the fan who asked what Matska meant, and her response to something along the lines of, do you not know how to Google, was freaking hilarious.
And two,
Tom, did you do something to your headset or something?
I just got it back on. I don't know what happened.
Okay.
Echo.
And number two, the thing that bugs me about Rusev is title range going to be 8 days.
Yeah, I disagree because I know where you're going with that, Patrick, but I disagree because Cena's already been announced for a 6-man tag at that episode of Raw.
I still think something's going to happen. I think Cena's going to end up taking the belt from him 8 days from tonight.
I don't disagree. Cena's taking the title, but I don't think it happens at Raw at the Memorial Day Raw.
United States title, Memorial Day, yeah, it's happening Memorial Day Raw.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if we get a match, but I think Cena's bound for that Money in the Bank match.
He already... He did that once. I don't see them doing that with him again.
I do.
I don't see him anywhere.
The main events, you know, so he's gonna have to do that. He's gonna have to do something.
Completely disagree, Tom. I don't see him anywhere near the Money in the Bank match coming off of a tournament.
No, that's what I'm saying. He's not gonna be in the main events. So the U.S. title is the obvious choice, theoretically.
Oh, I thought you were saying he was gonna be in the Money in the Bank match.
No.
Well, I disagree with everybody. I think John Cena is going to win not only that Monday, that U.S. title. I think he's going to win Money in the Bank, and I think he's going to win the Cruiserweight Classic this summer. So, anyway.
Can't let Roman outshine him.
Exactly.
You're a fly dog, Gary.
So, can you imagine John Cena shows up and like everybody's just like, oh, my God. He's going to bury everybody.
Are you saying in Hawaii, Shinsuke is going to be the king of making Cena look strong style?
Yeah.
If that match is even happening anymore, they said that card is totally off.
Yeah, I hear it.
I heard Vince was pissed that it got leaked.
Maybe.
That was always a lie because Brock was never on that show.
That's a shame. Yeah, they barely ever get matches down there. It's a shame.
Well, they hadn't been there since, what, like 7 years or something?
It's 2009, I believe, is the last time.
Yeah, which is ridiculous. That's seven. Well, Gary was not counting.
I was just saying 2009 was – I was agreeing. Yeah. But okay, anyway, we can be technical if we want. Let's go ahead, though. Let's get out of this. Let's talk about – because we got some more matches to talk about. Let's talk about, Sean, the women's match on this card. And, you know, I'm sure you have a lot to say about that, or maybe not that much.
It was going okay. I thought there were still sloppy parts in there. I don't know. I just feel like whatever chemistry they had in that NXT match is not here on the main roster. I don't know what it is. I felt like they were... It was more like, I guess Charlotte was trying to get the crowd into it ever. Jericho and Ambrose totally killed that crowd. But I just, it felt more like she was just wasting time in order for them to hit that point for Dana to come out. And, you know, Charlotte wasn't selling the leg. It was bonkers to me, a lot of that match. And then you get the ending, and that ending was... I mean, look, I don't have a problem with Dana being the person because, again, it makes sense for her as far as Natalya's a great hand that can help her get better in the ring. We know Dana's really good at her character. So, you know, her and Natty having face-offs promo-wise is going to be interesting. You know, I'm sure she'll do the patting Natty's head and all that stuff, and that'll make us laugh or whatever, and... You know, it'll be fine. Charlotte's obviously going on to Sasha, unless Sasha's really hurt. And in that case, maybe they have to hold off on that. But, you know, depending on the reports, whether they're true or not, if it's a head injury, then perhaps, you know, maybe she's not okay as quickly as they want. But, Yeah, I don't know. I just thought there was it wasn't very good. It wasn't as bad as Jericho Ambrose, but no.
Well, you know, you pointed out Natalya and, of course, Brooke, but who is going to face off against Charlotte next?
If Sasha's healthy, it's obviously her.
Okay.
If she's not, then, you know, they've got to figure out something. They don't really have – I guess they can throw Paige in there or outside of Sasha, who they've been having off TV because they're waiting for this big night. This is where they run into this problem where they ran through a lot of the people that she could have faced already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, those are good points. I appreciate that. You know, anybody else have anything you want to mention about the women's match before we move on?
I still think it should have been Will Nage.
Yeah, me too. I'm there.
I would have been perfectly okay with David Flair here. It made storyline sense to me.
They're not going to have a man go attack a woman in WWE.
You don't have to have Flair get physically involved. Just his presence at ringside alone breaks up.
What? So Natalya's going to slap him, and that's the payoff? I mean,
I don't know. I don't know what you do. You certainly don't do this though. This needed to be that home run swing that I keep talking about for these matches to actually matter, for the people to get involved and care. And you go and do something like this, and it just feels like same old Divas stuff, and you're left wondering if, yeah, you're left wondering if they're ever going to actually pull the trigger on making this thing seem like it matters more than outside of what they've done at Mania.
I think we're in a holding pattern with a women's title. I just really do. And I think, Sean, you said Sasha Banks. I think that's probably maybe the reason they're in this holding pattern. So,
I mean, but can you guys see any logic in what WWE's doing here? Like, the only thing I can think of is they think that screwing Natalya over is going to make people care more. And I just don't... Like, to me, you're already in a hole with the women. Presenting them as equal, doing shit finishes, is not going to make people go, oh, wow, this is great. Like,
that's the whole thing, because if Sasha is the end game here, if that's the big plan, wouldn't it make sense for Charlotte to look strong and get a big win straight up?
I would think so. I don't know why you didn't have her go over clean. That's going to be a head-scratcher for a long time here, because it's not like it's going to hurt Natty any.
Yeah, true.
I have no clue.
You know, Sean mentioned that the crowd was not very hyped up for this match because the Asylum match kind of killed them off, Patrick. You know, we've heard a lot of people so far on this show already talk about this match. Give us your complete thoughts on this and why it just did not live up to expectations.
It's something that I've talked about before. I just think the reason the match came off as so boring, which to me, you know, the first three quarters of it pretty much was boring to me, but I think it was the fact that the crowd wasn't in it. But that's kind of the risk you take putting this after a match that I think I and a lot of people thought was going to steal the show and did up until the last 3 seconds for me. Anyway, so that kind of just made most of the Asylum match, which to me the idea was sound. Yes, was it Lethal Lockdown? Yeah, pretty much, just without the roof. The idea wasn't there, and I didn't think it was necessarily bad, but like I said, the crowd just seemed dead from, you know, getting a instant classic immediately before, and because of that, you know, because the crowd wasn't there, the crowd wasn't into it, you know, it made the match worse than it actually was. And personally, I kind of would have liked if they had combined the Thumbtacks with Mitch Jr. and the Potted Plant, instead of having Dirt in it, had the Thumbtacks instead of the Bucket. I think that could have been a cool thing, kind of Mitch's revenge.
but it's weird because Jericho and Ambrose did not seem to mesh very well in this one to me. And it just made it seem like a meh match. And I think part of it was the crowd being so dead for it following the Fatal 4-Way.
I mean, I understand. Anybody else have any thoughts on this?
I mean, I certainly thought that at the going into it, but then as the match just kept going and going and going and going and going
and going
and going some more.
Energizer Bunny.
Yeah, there was nothing happening up until that last maybe 5 minutes.
And not only that, in hindsight, I think it might have been a better idea if Ambrose maybe brought down a garbage can full of weapons and then threw it in the cage and locked the door right away and kind of like forced the issue, so to speak, instead of having the weapons hung up above the cage and climbing for him. And then it got hokey after a while, I thought. Mm-hmm. And then when they put the tax out, you knew they were gone. Somebody taking a dive into it. But it seemed like it was forever between when they put the tax out and Jericho finally took the bump. And like you said,
I disagree with you, Tom. I actually like the fact that they teased the tag bump for as long as they did, because that is a bump that in current day WWE needed to mean something, and they made it mean something.
Well, that's just the old way of like how they used to like dig at ECW back in the day. Like they set up a table spot, but then they wouldn't go to it right away, which was nothing wrong with that, but it just seemed like it was too long, you know.
Yeah.
Sorry,
but that was the story of the match, though. Just too long.
Yeah, I agree with Paul. I agree with Paul there. I think this match probably was about 5 to 7 minutes longer than what it really needed to be.
I think it was
10
to
12 too long. It was about
10 minutes
too long.
Yeah.
That should have been a 15-minute match. You do the... And I totally agree with Tom and what Paul said. Do your... Pull your... They used to do this with Lethal Lockdown. You bring weapons into the match. Okay? And then you have other stuff hanging up there and whatever. So it's not just, oh, let me walk up to the cage, get the thing I want, wait, and then the other guy comes and punches. It's like, this is so stupid. Not to
and
mention...
Like once you, yeah, once you had the weapon and was laying there, it's like, well, I've already used that. I'll go get another one.
Yeah, it's like... This is it's like we're not playing WWE 2K whatever. This you're watching a match. And for one, it looks so stupid for you to waste energy to stop the other guy from taking the weapon down instead of waiting for him to come down. Don't waste energy and then clock him. So you're saving yourself from having to waste time to go up there and do all that. It's just like there's no logic to this. It's boring. You're waiting for everybody to get weapons. Half the time, they don't use them. And if they do, it's like Jericho barely touching Ambrose with the barbed wire thing. I mean, it's just like either go full bore with it for the everything or you just do the thumbtacks. It's just like basically it's the same thing as the Shane match at WrestleMania. You're waiting for that one spot. Thank God they had the thumbtacks because if not, it would have been the worst match in 2016. I mean, just it was terrible. It was bad.
But,
terrible planning.
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head there with the barbed wire. If you're gonna bring the barbed wire out, somebody's got to get cut.
Mm-hmm.
This is one of those times where getting that color wouldn't have hurt nobody.
Agreed. I agree 100% on that.
I just looked it up. You know, the ever popular Wikipedia for the match times. This is the longest match on this show, even over the main event. It goes 26 minutes.
Felt like 35.
Chris Jericho, stop wanting to go 25-minute matches, man. You can't do it no more.
Mm-hmm.
Can't do it. Just stop.
If you go 6 minutes with your mother.
What?
There's a sign on Instagram before.
I'm clearly in the minority here because I actually, by and large, enjoyed the match.
Man, it's like you and that Triple H and Reigns. You're just enjoying those bad matches this year.
It was a gimmick match. It was silly. Nothing super spectacular happened, but we expected that to happen, right? I mean, this is not Attitude Era. This is not ECW. This is no time where they're willing to take the risk that need to be taken in a match like this. So I was not too terribly disappointed because I didn't have my hopes up high.
I think that's the biggest problem here is that people were maybe coming into this match with too high of expectations. The match at Payback was not the greatest match either at that show, but at the same time, if you knew what you were getting at those two at Payback, and then you got something relatively similar with a couple of, let's be honest here, a couple of pretty cool weapon spots as well, then I don't see a reason to be disappointed here. Yes, the match was too long, I agree. But that being said, I don't think it was unentertaining. I think that the crowd was dead, and that played a large role in the fact that the match seemed as long as it did. But it wasn't a bad match, in my opinion.
It was far from the worst match ever, but like you said, following that four-way and then going an eternity here, just a recipe for disaster.
Ultimately, it found its way in the last 5 minutes, but a good 5 minutes out of 26 is not a good thing.
Very true. And, you know, probably the only thing that would have made this match really worth anything is to have Baron Corbin in it, right? So,
How you know me, Gary.
I know.
Do you guys think this is it for Jericho for this run? Because there was talk he was done after Payback, and then he came in and did Extreme Rules. Do you guys think this is it for Jericho?
Unless he wants to do Money in the Bank again or something like that, I don't really know if there's a lot left for him right now currently, just because I don't know if there's another guy who needs a big, important feud right now. I mean, maybe if he comes back in 6 months, I'm sure he'll have that spot ready.
Yeah, the only person I could think of coming out of tonight's show that might need a feud is Styles, and they're not going to go down that road again already.
Right.
No, please don't. Please do not.
God,
no.
Oh, no. For God's sake, they're not doing that again.
Yeah.
Jericho needs to just go.
I agree.
For a little while. Just, you've done all you could. I don't know who. There was no one else there for him to wrestle. Just.
I wouldn't be opposed to seeing Jericho and Cesaro, but other than that.
I don't think Cesaro and Miz is over yet.
No.
No, with the way the match finished tonight, the four-way, with the way that finished tonight, I wouldn't be surprised if Miz and Cesaro was over. And I stand by what I said when we were talking to Anthony as well, that I feel like Miz's title reign has been important enough with this particular run with the SC title that it needs to happen where he loses it in a one-on-one match.
Mm-hmm. Let's move on from this, guys. We've talked enough about this Asylum match. Let's talk about this Fatal 4-Way that we keep praising, and we really kind of touched on it, but we've not delved into it, Tom. Give us your thoughts on this match and why you enjoyed it.
I think nobody expected Miz to win. I don't think anybody expected Miz to win, but the fact that he won, I don't think hurt the match at all. But this match, it's just, you know, everybody expected your Owens or Sami Zayn to win, probably, I would assume, but just from the start when Zayn did the kick on Owens, and they all just stood there and looked at each other before they really started, and then it just went from there, and the near falls and the uppercut by Cesaro. Especially the one on Zayn where he's coming off. I think he was coming off the rope at one point. Where he threw him up in like a backdrop or something. And he just nailed him with that uppercut forearm. That was awesome. The near falls were great. Everybody got their stuff in. And that crowd, when they started singing for Zayn, you just wanted him to win so bad. But it was great.
Yeah, I mean, I agree, and I think all of us really enjoyed this match. It was, you know, definitely a big highlight of tonight. Now, saying that, I mean, it looks like the storylines are pretty clear here. You know, you're going to have, of course, Kevin Owens facing off against his, you know, friend and foe at the same time, Sami Zayn. And then, you know, where Cesaro and The Miz go from here, I'm not sure. In your best estimation, Tom, where do you think The Miz is going from here? Who is he going to face?
I'll tell you what, I think this match is going to, like, take a life on of its own as far as, because at the end when Cole said the match is a year candidate, you never hear a WWE announcer say something like that. And I really think they should.
Hello?
Did we lose Tom?
Ah, oh, crap.
Uh-oh.
Well, thank God we didn't lose everybody. I thought the internet
okay,
went out again.
Okay, here we are.
There you go, Tom.
All right. No, I was saying, this match is going to take a life of its own as far as being, like, legendary, I think. So, you could theoretically do versions of this match at the next two pay-per-views. Twist the title if you want. And then come back and rematch at a SummerSlam. All four guys.
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, since we've gotten to the point where we kind of covered everybody that's sort of important, the issue you have is, I know we sort of talked about Cena at one point, but let's take Cena out of this because he's kind of that guy that he could be in that match. But you have to wonder, with him being having just come back from an injury, do they want to put him in that kind of match? So let's take Cena out of it. Wouldn't all four of these guys, or at least everybody but Miz, be in the Money in the Bank match?
I think you could put all four of these guys, even Miz, into the Money in the Bank ladder match, because A, I think that their performance in this match warrants them having a high placement on the Money in the Bank card, and what better way to do that than to put them in arguably the second most important match on the Money in the Bank card besides your title match, that being the Money in the Bank ladder match itself. B, I don't think that having Miz having a singles match one-on-one at the Money in the Bank pay-per-view is going to be enough for him. And I know that we've talked about the importance of the secondary titles here, but I go back to what I said earlier. Miz is making this Intercontinental title seem important during this one. He's doing more for this Intercontinental title during this one than Kalisto did for the U.S. title, for damn sure.
Well, you can have Miz defend the title at Money in the Bank against pick one of the other three, and then the other two can be a Money in the Bank.
I think you're doing a disservice to all four of these men in the performance they put in tonight by having a standard singles one-on-one match.
Well, but let's think about it like this. You know you're going to have Ambrose be in that match. You know you're going to have either Rollins. It's, you know, Rollins could be in that match because, you know, the rumor is supposed to be Reigns and Cena probably for SummerSlam. And, you know, we don't know. They could go with Rollins for Reigns, or they can go with Cena for Reigns, whatever. They could put Rollins in the Money in the Bank. I don't think he should win. He already won once. That doesn't make sense. And I guess what they would probably put Ziggler in there just because.
Maybe I'm crazy here. And I'm sorry, Sean. Maybe I'm crazy, but I think Styles might be the preeminent Money in the Bank.
Oh, yeah, AJ.
Favorite.
Yeah. I forgot about AJ.
Actually, if you want to go with Cena, Cena and Reigns at SummerSlam, I don't think is a lock, even though that's what they said. Let's just suppose they have Reigns against Rollins at SummerSlam. Supposedly, Nakamura is going to be on the main roster by then, so why not Nakamura Cena?
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
Or they could do AJ Cena, or AJ Nakamura SummerSlam, since they know each other. Wouldn't be hard for, you know, you're going to get a great match or whatever.
Yeah, it'll be decent.
My problem with the idea is if you put, okay, between AJ and Rollins, whoever is not, or whoever's going to be in the ladder match, the other one's going to be in the championship match, because you've got to think that they're going to have Reigns versus somebody for the title. So the question then becomes, who gets put in the ladder match? Who gets put in the title match? Do you give AJ one last shot and put Rollins in the Money in the Bank? Or
they could put either
on Rollins' return and he face Reigns and put AJ in the ladder match.
I wonder if they might even do a triple threat or something like that, where they do like a number one contender match on Raw, and then they don't have a decision, so they give it to, they tell them, okay, both of them against Reigns at Money in the Bank, and
that's the only way I could see it being a triple threat there, because I don't think how you could, I don't think how you can decisively still name AJ Styles as the number one contender having lost two pay-per-views in a row.
Yeah, but he got screwed by the Uso messing with his leg. You don't do that unless there's not something to that.
I agree. It's rare that you see a babyface cause a non-finish in a main event off of a major spot there, but at the same time, they had to do something to protect the Clash on the Chair, too.
I don't think they cared about protecting anything.
They didn't.
That has more to do with... That has to do something. Either they give it to him on Raw, or they give it to him something. Something's going to happen there with that, I'd imagine. Or that sets up the... why the club turns on him or whatever, because he gets mad at him for not helping him or whatever. I don't know, but...
Can I ask Tom a question real quick?
Shoot.
Why is it that you felt nobody predicted Miz to win this match? I actually, when we did our predictions on the reaction, I did predict Miz.
You know, nobody takes Miz.
I think two of us predicted Miz, too.
I know I did.
Yeah.
Really? So people pick Miz? I was surprised. Huh.
The reason I'm not surprised people pick Miz here is because, like I've been saying this entire night, I think this has been a pretty good run by Miz, and you don't end it in a four-way. Plus, there are other storylines to develop in this match that would have led to Miz keeping the title. I didn't expect Cesaro to be the one to eat the pinfall, but I did see Miz walking out still champion.
You know what? I agree. I agree with Miz keeping the title, because now there's so much he can do with the four guys and keep the feud going.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's where the real big tip of the hat comes in here, is this match did such a great job booking-wise for everybody involved, because not Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens were so busy beating the piss out of each other that they cost each other the belt, essentially. And then Miz is the only way he can beat Cesaro is because Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens both hit their finishers on him. So, I mean, this is some really, really nice booking done here by the WWE.
Can I also give credit to Cesaro real quick as well for his reaction to that opening Kaluva kick? And just the look of stunned silence on Cesaro's face as soon as the bell rang, Sami rang Kevin's bell with the haluva.
Yeah, I was about to say, it's because Sami Zayn murdered him. He killed Kevin Owens for 5 minutes.
Well, I think, you know, Miz, too, he was the foundation of this match. You know, a lot of it was based around him, what he was doing. Maurice got involved at that one key spot there. So, I mean... A lot of people like to shit on Miz, you know, Patrick included, but he was a major part of this match, and, you know, a lot of times you would take that away from him.
I don't understand how people can continue to knock the Miz, especially during this run, because ever since he got the Intercontinental title back the night after WrestleMania, in my opinion, Miz has been on fire this year. Mm-hmm. Look who he had.
He's been on fire, though, since that little feud with AJ, like... That promo where he was just being a total troll with AJ or whatever, the night after Royal Rumble, man, he was great.
He's on fire because the act is hot with Maurice. It's not by himself now, you know, so he's got a whole package.
I don't know if I agree with that, Tom. I think Maurice definitely adds to the character, but at the same time, I think Miz has been doing more than enough on his own volition as well.
Oh, yeah, but he was stale for a while, you know, before he left and then came back. And
He had that one little thing, and then remember him and Jericho had a stupid feud over the talk show, too. And he was involved in that thing with AJ. He was a secondary character to Jericho and AJ. And then when Maurice came, that's when he really started changing that character into, like, oh, now he's going to be reciting classic movie lines, and he's going to be even a bigger douche because you hate Maurice so much because of her speaking French and her, you know, people were booing the total crap. They boo the crap out of them every time, you know, she makes out with him on TV. It's just, she adds so much to him as a character. Like Tom said, it's like you have this cake. It's not that good, but then you start you add Maurice, and it's like you add the icing and you add the sprinkles and the whatever, and then it's like, oh, wow, now you have this awesome cake that you're looking at.
Yeah.
And there's the Miz.
Exactly. You know, the reason this works is because this is exactly what Sean's saying here. This is Hall & Oates. I mean, you look for perfection, you have, there you go, Hall & Oates right here, the Miz. And
well, I'm not going to dispute you on Hall & Oates being perfection, Gary, but...
Yeah, so...
You know.
Simon and Garfunkel.
I can totally go for that.
Yeah, definitely.
I just think Miz can go right to hell.
let me ask Patrick a question here, because I'm curious.
No, I'm going the Rusev route. No.
Oh, you got... Hey, if we're going to bring in Rusev in here, you know, he's got private eyes watching him. So you definitely got to make sure you answer that question.
Oh, Christ.
Good Lord.
I'm curious, Ketza, what specifically about Miz is it that irritates you so that you can't acknowledge his presence in this match?
Okay, fine. You want to try and say that Miz's run with the Intercontinental title was better than Kalisto's run with the U.S. title? Look at who the hell he had to work with.
Okay, quality of opposition I'll give you.
He and Ryback had a pretty good match, that second one.
Okay, but it's still only Ryback. While Miz has had Kevin Owens, Sami Zayn, Chris Jericho, AJ Styles, and towards the end, you know, now Cesaro. You know, so there's definitely a higher quality there. And I'm sorry, but to this day, I still absolutely despise him. And this is not a you're a good heel hatred. And by the way, he fucking ruined one of my favorite Disney movies of all time by being an ass and reciting the scene tonight because I absolutely love Miracle. So screw him for that. And Patrick just dropping up. Huh?
It's okay. It's 2 in the morning Eastern time. He's good.
Okay.
I want him gone. Not in a good heel kind of way. Xbox, get the hell off my screen and don't come back.
Well,
see, you're in a minority though there, because I think Miz is excellent at drawing heel heat, but I think it's the good kind of heel heat, not the Xbox heat.
For me, it's the Xbox heat. And I know one wrestler who agrees with me, too. And she absolutely despises him as well.
All right.
Huh? Okay. So.
But I want him gone. I want the belt off him. And that's legitimately what ruined the Fatal 4-Way for me, was the fact that out of any of the three, he ends up worming his way out with that damn belt. I want him out of the belt. I want him just gone.
Well, you know what, Patrick? We're doing WrestleMania 27 soon, just to irritate you even further.
Oh,
go to hell, Harry.
Oh, don't make me watch any more WrestleManias, for God's sake.
Oh, man.
No. We're looking at a couple of months before we go back to WrestleManias.
Oh,
yeah. But
I want to do WrestleMania 27 just to piss off.
No.
I just want to say this. The Miz needs to be thankful that Patrick has not worked for the wellness group, you know, that way, you know, because he would be failed immediately. Just walk into the door, he'd be failed. So,
I wouldn't even give him a chance to piss in the cup. I'd fire him already.
Oh, yeah, you could say, say that Miz couldn't pee in the cup like Hornswoggle and you give him a suspension.
Fire.
Good. I could just imagine. I'm sorry. I'm just picturing this right now. Patrick's got the cup, and the Miz is trying to pee in, and he just keeps moving the cup. Nope. You can't get it. Nope. Anyway, enough about that visual.
I found you $1.
Yeah. Oh, jeez. So, guys, I mean, we ran into the whole card here. A lot of great stuff. We had some great calls, but we've got to do a couple things here before we get to our rating. We need to talk about the fact that we all agree, really, on the worst match. And we are going to go ahead and include the pre-show here. You guys already mentioned, and a lot of people have already mentioned, the silent match was not as good as it was advertised to be. The women's match was not something that we were thrilled about at the end. But really, honestly, we have Baron Corbin and Dolph Ziggler to thank for having probably the least entertaining match here on this entire card. Does anybody want to say anything about that before we move on? Because not a whole lot to say about that. I mean, so I think this silence is gold, and we've kind of talked about it enough. Let's talk about, though, the real controversy we have here, and that is the fact that we are in a tie right now for the best match of the night. We have three, four, the Fatal 4-Way, and we have three for the main event. So the way we're going to work this out is we're going to go head-to-head, and we are going to talk this out really quickly. Tom, you are a fan of the Fatal 4-Way. Paul, you like the main event. Tom, give us your reasons. This is court. Give us your reasons why the Fatal 4-Way deserves it.
Four guys just tore down the house, and the crowd never recovered afterwards.
They didn't recover until we got to the main event, which totally knocked the ball out of the park. I think it was two guys that worked very well. Both matches had the strength of great work rate and well-booked. I think I got more enjoyment out of the main event more than anything.
Harry, you voted for the Fatal 4-Way. Patrick, you voted for the main event. Give me your thoughts, Harry.
Balls to the wall action from all four men from bell to bell. It was almost 20 minutes of them not slowing down at all. There were no noticeable rest spots at any point during the match. There was always action going on between at least two participants, and usually they worked in three or all four people for the matches there. It's everything you'd ask for from a Fatal 4-Way.
Patrick?
We kind of got what we were expecting with all six men ended up being involved, but they gave Reigns and AJ a lot of time to themselves first, and they took full advantage of it with a lot of cool spots, you know, involving like barriers and the pre-show set and everything, and it made good on the Extreme Rules stipulation and came up with a lot of creative spots to do with the added attractions that they had to work with.
Fair enough. All right, Sean, you are for the Fatal 4-Way, and I picked the main event. So give me your reasons why the Fatal 4-Way really does deserve it.
I mean, like Tom said when we were doing this, it's, you know, Larry gave him the same rating. I gave him the same rating when I was sitting there doing it, just after I watched the match, 4.5. I mean, it's really grabbing hairs. I think for the purity of wrestling, that's why I gave it the Fatal 4-Way. Just four guys going out there, giving it their everything, the match that we knew would steal the show, and they got the time, and they did it. They stole the show. There wasn't a dead spot in the match. They were just... I mean, there was also that time with, you know, AJ and Reigns had to get to that part in the where they got to the back where they started doing more than brawling. That took a little bit, you know. So, again, I'm being really picky here, but that's kind of what you got to do when you got 1 and 1A. And that's why I'm saying if I got to pick a best match, that's why I'm saying Fatal 4-Way.
Fair enough, and you make a lot of great points, and all of you have. And the reason I picked the main event simply was because I just felt like the story here was entertaining from start to finish. We did get some things happening where we thought they would happen, which what I'm talking about is the interference. Kind of the same way it goes to the Fatal 4-Way, though. We all pretty much came into this knowing that Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens were going to cancel each other out. That ended up happening just like that. And, you know, we did kind of think maybe The Miz would win this because really Cesaro, as IC champion right now, does not look like it's in the cards. So I go back to the main event and just say I was entertained. There were moments where I was kind of thinking to myself, wow, Reigns is going to win this, right? I questioned it at times because I really felt like they did a good job selling to me that, hey, there could be a possibility AJ Styles could win. So that's why I went main event. To break this tie, though, we've got to do a little bit of brainstorming here. I know Anthony called in and told us live the main event was his favorite. Rick called in and said that the Fatal 4-Way was. Does anybody remember what Glenn said?
Glenn said the Fatal 4-Way as well.
All right. Fatal 4-Way wins. That is the best match of the night because that's the tiebreaker right there. So, but yeah, great stuff, guys. I mean, there you go. The controversy kind of solved. Let's talk about our MVPs and our ratings for this show. Harry, we're going to start with you, man. What was your MVP and your rating?
It's really tough to name a single MVP here because of the seven standout performances. The four men involved in the four-way, the two actual participants in the main event, and then obviously the returning Seth Rollins here. But to me, I think I'm going to give it to Sami Zayn and the fact that he was so emotionally invested in and had the fans so emotionally invested in his performance, more so than Cesaro did during the course of the Fatal 4-Way. So I'm going to give my MVP to Sami Zayn, and I'm going to give the show an 8.
All right. Tom, what was your thoughts? MVP and rating.
MVP goes to Styles. He was a one-man wrecking ball. That backdrop he did onto the table was unbelievable. And I think, like Sean said, once they got to the point that crowd was totally behind it in the near fall that he got, where off the Styles clash was awesome. But Styles just was great in this match. And as far as rating, between that main event and the four-way, I can't go anything less than an 8.
And then you've got that moment where he... that moment where he goes crazy with the chair was insane.
Loved it.
It was just like, wow. He snapped, it's like, oh, you lose your mind, snap, watching it.
Oh, I had a total Austin Rock WrestleMania 17 moment there. I thought for sure that was going to be the finish.
I loved it. I want to see the GIF on that one. I got to find it. So, Paul, what was yours? Rating and MVP.
I'm agreeing with the MVP with Tom here. It's AJ Styles. Absolutely worked one hell of a match. I think he damn near died trying to make Reigns look strong tonight, so hats off to him there. I was going to go 7.5. I gave it an 8 on the poll just because we don't do halves on there on the page. I'll be 8. We'll go 8.
Patrick?
This is probably going to seem weird, and I know I'm not the only one that's going to, I think, do this, but I will actually give it to Seth Rollins for the MVP just because he was able to make the crowd care about his return, and they didn't need his music, and that 30 seconds or let's say 1 minute of him being out there, the crowd went ballistic. The crowd has wanted him to come back. They have been hoping and waiting for him to come back. So I'm excited to see where it goes. But just that one moment of him holding the belt up and the crowd is losing their minds while it's going on. In terms of the show itself, there's nothing, egregiously, horrifically bad about this show. As a matter of fact, a lot of it is, really quite good. The Fatal 4-Way, aside from the ending, strictly in my opinion. I love the cluster that was the main event. So I'm not going to go quite that high, though, but I will still give this show a 7.
Sean?
I'm going to go with an 8 as well. The guys pretty much said everything. When you got two match of the year candidate matches, and then you've got pretty much other than, the women's match and the Asylum match, this could have really been one of those. If those are better, and you're maybe looking at one of those where you say, oh, this is a 9, and we're in May. We're in 3 months, 2 months in the WWE's calendar, which goes from, March or April to the next March or April. I mean, that's pretty insane that we're talking about some pretty good pay-per-views after WrestleMania. And one that could have really been something if especially one that was really hyped as much as the women's match was, and then what they did to it, it really kind of hurt that way. But there's not a whole lot to complain about with this pay-per-view. I'm going to say an 8. And I know there's a lot of people that... let me run this down really quick. I have a lot of diversity here with these ratings. You had about 15 people give it a 7. You had 11 people give it an 8. You had about 6 different people give it a 5. You had a few 9s in here, a couple of 10s, 4s, and a 6. So,
some diversity. I'm sorry.
But, go ahead.
I'm sorry, and this is my honest opinion here. Anybody 6 or lower is trolling.
I don't think so. The people that... The person that gave it a 6, he gave his honest opinions about why. But, you know.
All right. I can't.
So you got to remember, some people grade harder on things, you know. Pretty standard grading system, but there's people that grade really hard, you know.
Cough, cough, wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
Yeah, but when you have 2 great matches like that, if you give it a 6, you're complaining about too much.
Oh, I agree. He is complaining about too much. You know, but I'm just saying, you know. He's not like the people that gave it a 4. I can tell you they're guys that kind of just hate everything. So I kind of disregard that. But I'm still saying the majority here is positive. Other than the 6 people that are going with 5s.
I'm not presently on my computer. Who gave it a 6?
Brandon's the one that gave it a 6, but you've got people that aren't so active in the group. They're sort of relatively new. One guy that is in there a lot, but I think he kind of has his things where, I don't want to mention names, but just it seemed like the main event really bothered him, and, you know, I guess that kind of took him out of it. He gave it a 5, but, you know. Again, most of this is positive. You've got about, almost 21, 22? Well, if you include all of us, so some of us didn't vote on there, you've got about at least 24, 25 people that gave it anywhere from, I want to say more like 30, that gave it anywhere from a 10 to a 7. So, you know.
One of your regular guests on W2M, who I know is somewhat of a harsh rater, Tom, what was Fonty's rating?
Fonty has not seen the show yet, so I doubt that he graded anything yet.
Okay.
Yeah.
He's the one that got really upset about the person that posted a video about Seth Rollins returning, and I did not see it until after it had already been up on the page for a while. So,
shout out to Fonty.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Okay, Sean, did you give your MVP? I can't remember.
Oh, AJ is my MVP.
AJ, okay, cool. My MVP will have to go to Michael Cole. I'm kidding. AJ Styles.
The troll is strong with this one.
Yeah, exactly. Now, AJ Styles for me, you guys said everything, so there's no need for me to rehash it, but I will say this. I would have gave this show a 8 instead of a 7 if Mauro Ranallo would have been in call. So, there you go.
Well, shoot, that would have been like a 10 if Mauro Ranallo was calling it.
Maybe. Maybe a 9.
Did you listen to that? You know what? We were bad on the pre-show, but what I'll say is Mauro Ranallo did something on the pre-show that I think it would have gone over Michael Cole's head. He made the big deal about the low blow with Baron Corbin, and he's like, because Baron, that's part of his character. Baron Corbin does it because he can. And I think Michael Cole would have just, that went totally over his head. So, mm-hmm. You know, it's the same thing where, like, Mauro Ranallo made it a point on SmackDown that Jericho ran out of the cage. He said, Jericho's not going to be able to do that at Extreme Rules. Another place where I think JBL or Michael Cole would have just totally miffed on that. So, there is a thing to having wonderful commentary and how much that means.
Totally agree. So, well, that runs us out of Extreme Rules Talk, guys. We've talked about everything. We've run in the card, our ratings, MVPs, all that good stuff. So that moves us on. And, Sean, I mean, we've kind of run longer. Are we still doing some New Japan talk here?
Yes, we are.
Okay, so Does that mean who's all sticking around for that?
That we means did not... Harry and Patrick are probably gone for this.
All right. Well, I want to start by saying, we definitely appreciate everybody who called in for the Extreme Rules talk. Make sure we thank Anthony for sure. It's great talk. Appreciate the live perspective. Also want to thank Rick Balin and of course, Glenn Smith, those guys for calling in as well. Love having those guys call in. And Patrick Ketza, man, you are Wrestling Unwrapped. We want to know what's going to happen on the next episode. Do you guys have a plan?
We're kind of finalizing that before we went on here with this. So, yes, we Harry, Sean, and myself will all be back next Sunday night at our usual time, 8 Eastern, 7 Central, when Harry and I will head back west and do the first ever tribute show to a fallen rock star that PWG ever did, when we cover PWG's Dio, and especially with the fact that they've now had to do 3 rock star tribute shows this year, with their latest being Prince, kind of fits with the theme of what's been going on this year. So that will be our return following tonight's W2M, and that'll be at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, right here on the W2M Network.
All right, thank you, Patrick. And, of course, Mr. Harry Broadhurst, not only from Wrestling Unwrapped, but also the Raw Reaction. Kind of give us know where we can hear you guys tomorrow night.
All right, real quick before I do this, I want to say thank you once again to my buddy Anthony Morello for calling in and giving us the live perspective. Much appreciated, and I know I kind of sprung that on you last minute, and I want to thank you again for being kind enough to be able to join us here. Myself, Tony Acero, the aforementioned Rick Balin, and the most valuable producer, Jimmy Christopher, all due respect, Sean, will have the Raw Reaction for you tomorrow night at 11:30 p.m. We cover the return to Raw of the architect, Seth Rollins, as well as everything that starts us on our road to Money in the Bank. That is tomorrow night, 11:30 p.m., the Raw Reaction on DeMarco Wrestling Radio.
Awesome, guys. Man, well, I appreciate both of you. This is a great way for us to finally get back together. And, I hope you guys enjoy the new intro. You'll have to go back and listen to the beginning of the show and tell us what you think. Tell me what you think about that intro. So,
Real quick, Sean, do you have Dio or are me and Patrick flying solo on that next Sunday?
I'll see if I can figure out a way to watch it. If not, then I'll let y'all know and you'll be doing it solo.
All right.
Thanks, guys. I'll catch up with y'all next Sunday for Wrestling Unwrapped.
Later. Later, you guys.
Go
ahead.
Talk to you later.
Later.
Later, Patrick.
All right, Sean. Well, it's all yours. Let's talk some New Japan.
All right.
King of Sport. New Japan Pro Wrestling.
All right, so New Japan's Best of Super Juniors tournament started on Saturday morning. I watched it live with all the people on Twitter, and then I had to rewatch some of the matches for the review that I will finish writing as soon as I get done with this, and watch the Night 2 matches, which Tom will get to talk a little bit about here, since you watch them all, Tom.
I had it on. Pretty much the last 3 matches I watched, pretty much. I still have to rewatch it again just to really get a better feel for it.
All right. This was a live show, so it had an entire card. Most of the shows that aren't live will only have the Best Super Junior matches. So, like, tomorrow when we do Night 2 and 3, those will only be the tournament matches, which is probably better once you get past this first show, because they really get into the territory where they drag a ton. It's just your normal tag match central at that point. The first match was sort of a of course, if you don't understand how this Best of the Super Juniors works, it's 2 blocks, very much like the G1 last year. You have an A block, which is the ones that will have their matches on this show that we're about to talk about, and the B block guys, which they're scattered through the tag matches, but you had the first match here was sort of a showcase for some of these B-Block guys. So you had Satoshi Kojima, Volador Jr., and Bobby Fish against Tomohiro Ishii, Beretta, and Will Ospreay. You kind of got a little bit of what all these guys are going to be able to do, at least, you know, the four juniors, and then maybe we're getting an Ishii Kojima contest here. Tom, what do you think about this?
It was exciting as they started off with Ospreay and Volador, that, you know, kick off the night, morning, whatever it was. So I really enjoyed those two. And Ishii and Kojima look like could be a nice start to something if they go that route. Although Kojima is now going to be put in the Tanahashi spot, which we'll get to later. But really looking for the things like Volador and Ospreay. And Ospreay and Volador against everybody, really. But it was a good opener. It really was fun. It seemed like on this tour, if you look at the lineups, they have different pairings than usual. You know, like this was an odd pairing: Ishii, Beretta, and Ospreay against Volador, Fish, and Kojima. You know, you'd usually see Kojima with like the old guys, but it's fun to see him in there with the juniors and stuff.
I mean, both of you guys have watched this longer than me. Do you know a reason why they would take the barricades out? It was just weird that they just took the barricades out and you had guys basically flipping into people's laps.
Oh, where they had the announce table on that side. I think they took the barricade out. Yeah, you're right.
It was like at one point Volador almost fell on somebody, and then they had to get, when Bushi did his suicide dive, they had to get a bunch of the young lions in front of the crowd because he would have hit people.
And that's usually what...
Yeah, I wonder if they did that for the junior guys to do some flying into the crowd. You know, because Cork is kind of small there around ringside, and you got to have some place to land.
Oh, okay.
They normally barricade up Cork in though, so I don't know why they didn't. Yeah. That thought didn't cross my mind when I was watching. I only watched the tournament matches, by the way. But yeah.
Well, we had the old guys, Tiger Mask, Jushin Thunder Liger, and Yuji Nagata against Jay White, Juice Robinson, and Katsuhiro Shibata. I thought this was sort of okay. You kind of had a lot of the same stuff that you've seen from Nagata and Shibata. Not that it gets boring, but it's a lot of the same kind of spots. And they're just kind of filling time. And, you know, Grumpy Tiger Mask and Liger kind of doing tag match Liger aren't necessarily always the best. It was really more about Jay kind of getting a little cocky. And then Nagata puts him down. That's what I said. I thought this was okay. I didn't think it was anything totally special. But what did you think, Tom?
Real quick, go back to the first match. I thought the finish was kind of surprising. It was Volador pinning Beretta. I thought maybe there might have been like a Kojima pinning Beretta or something. You know, keep the junior guys not pinning each other in the tag matches. So that one kind of surprised me. And the only thing about this match that really of note to me was Jay White. And he was just fired up and cocky, you know, really playing that up. And I think time has passed Tiger Mask by. He just, I don't know.
Yeah.
He's just there now. Mm-hmm. Flabby. And time's caught up to him, I think.
Yeah. He bland and uninteresting, I think, are two adjectives that fit him well.
Yeah, certainly. Especially for this match where he didn't do a whole lot. Then you have Bullet Club B Team with Kenny Omega of Kenny Omega, Bad Luck Fale, Yujiro Takahashi. Yujiro doesn't even tag into this match, thank God for all of us. And Chase Owens against Hiroshi Tanahashi, Yoshi, Triple H, Captain New Japan, and Ricochet, which Yoshitatsu only does the the chin buster in this match. He doesn't do any other Triple H isms other than spit in the water. But it's really not a good sign when the only other guy wearing the Bullet Club Hunter stuff is Captain New Japan. It tells you a lot about where you are. But Ricochet pretty much owns the first part of this match. And then the rest of it is just very boring Bullet Club stuff. It's mainly an angle so you can get to Kenny Omega destroying Tanahashi's arm, doing concertos to the arm with it trapped in the ladder, and all that, just totally smashing Tanahashi to the point where it gets stretchered out. And I really hope that this means Tanahashi's not wrestling the rest of the tour. This guy needs a break like nobody's business. And I hope that's what he's getting here. But do you think anything here, Tom?
Well, he's off the rest of the tour. And Kojima's taking his spot. So I wonder if Kojima will be running, like, with Omega in the tag matches, like, as a backup plan for Dominion. The only other thing about the match, really, the highlight of the match to me was Omega when he came out with the broom and was just taunting that lady in the front row.
Yes.
Just would not stop with that. I mean, she must have been freaking out. He played that up. Oh, my God, I was laughing so hard.
He used this mop and he knocked her Tana towel away and then that bastard knocked the Tana Teddy away. He got all of us mad on Twitter. And then he...
I put the mop on her head.
He put the mop on her head. And then afterwards, he was talking junk to her, too. And knocked the teddy bear away again. It was like, man, just totally bashing this lady.
As far as the angle goes, that was really good angle. Was the ladder and the chair and everything?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was good. That was really good. Just the Bullet Club being the Bullet Club, and the crowd really ate this up. So that's they accomplished what they wanted to there. With at least the crowd got into it. It would have been really bad if they were dead, but you know. So it's at least building well to this. Then you get Los Gobernables de Japón versus Chaos tag match. Naito, Sanada, and Evil against Okada, Goto, and Yoshihashi. Okada and Naito kind of did enough. This was really more about Yoshihashi and Sanada once again at the end here have a terrific series where Yoshihashi has some nice near falls, makes you think he's going to win. Sanada eventually puts him in the Dragon Sleeper. But, man, Yoshihashi just been, he's been having a killer year. Ever since Nakamura left, it really feels like he's taken it upon himself to be a player in Chaos. And Goto still feels like he's kind of finding himself. He's not totally there. Him and Evil kind of did okay, but it was certainly the not that great part of the match. Anything for you, Tom, here?
I think the match was basically a backdrop to put heat on Sonata. But you're right, the last several minutes with Sonata and Yoshihashi was great. Because first Yoshihashi got out of the counter the Dragon Sleeper. And then went on a tear with a couple of near falls himself, and then Sonata finally hooked it in. But I don't know what it is with Goto. They're gonna find something for him, or if it's up to me, I'm still teaming him and Ishii up and having a tag run.
Yeah, I mean, what do you think, Paul?
I think that's still the end goal here for Goto and Ishii. I don't know how long the Gorillas of Destiny are going to get a run with that belt, because I think maybe Sanada and Evil, or Evil and Bushi, or some combination of Los Ingobernables are going to win those belts sooner rather than later. So I think having Goto and Ishii chase those guys might be better for New Japan, I think, in the long term.
Yeah, then you have, you know, this whole series of matches with those, and then you throw Makabe and Hanma in there.
Mm-hmm.
You can run that all the way to the Dome next year. It'll be exciting.
Yeah, true. And speaking of exciting, here we go with the rest of these are best of Super Juniors matches, and boy, do they all deliver for their own reasons. The first one was Rocky Romero against the David Finley Jr., who, this is where he debuted last year, but he is a replacement this year for one of the Jacksons, I think it's Nick. So, you know, David Finley attacked Rocky Romero before the bell and just went super aggressive on him. He even took him out to the front part of the, I guess it was the front part of Kurikan, and he smashed his head against a beam that's there and took him all the way around the ring, just kept hitting him. Just, man, he was going nuts here, just really wanting to win. He really wanted to show that, hey, you don't take me lightly kind of thing. Romero eventually was able to slow it down, and he did a Nakamura tribute, which was really well received, and then he eventually won. But, man, just terrific way to start the tournament.
This was a great way to start the tournament, because when he attacked him before the bell, I just popped. I was, you know, my buddy was getting, you know, snacks in the kitchen. I'm like, dude, he attacked him before the bell. They're going all over Cork. And, you know, so I wasn't expecting that. And it was exciting. And then, you know, all the fire that he showed. And I was trying to remember where the Nakamura tribute was. And that's what it was. Yeah, when he did the thing with the hands coming out of the corner. That was awesome. And,
He puts him on top of the turnbuckle and does the knees.
Right, he did it on top of the knees and everything. Oh, it's really amazing how they're keeping his name alive over there in New Japan. It's cool, actually, also, but yeah, this match delivered.
Yeah, Romero is just so, so good. Like, the steady hand here versus Finley's young rage. Mostly because Finley's looking to prove himself, and because Finley is a Finley, and he's pretty much a smaller version of his dad, which is somehow more terrifying because he can flip on top of all this. So I'm really looking forward to the rest of Finley's matches. I don't think he's going to win any, but he's certainly going to make every single one of them interesting because he has something to prove in a bad way.
I disagree. He's going to win one match. And he's going to beat Gato. I guarantee it.
Man. This next one that we're about to talk about surprised me, because I thought Bushi was going to go pretty long in this tournament, but I'm questioning myself now. But if he beats Gato, my God.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing with Gato is last year,
he started 2-0 last year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he started. Sorry, I've got somebody that's really upset about the. Apparently, they got spoiled, and now they don't want to watch Extreme Rules. That's what happens when you got like 5 people deciding they want to post in there, and I can't go in there and delete everything while we're trying to do this at the same time. But either way, I mean, this was, you know, a little bit. You've got the Chaos versus Los Ingenuos feud in this match by itself, and you've also got Okada came on commentary during the intermission, so he's basically on commentary for the entirety of the Best Super Juniors matches, and so, you know, on commentary, Okada is basically, he's asked, who do you think he's going to win, and he picks Ospreay. And he's like, well, they're like, why didn't you pick Gato? And he starts laughing. You can audibly hear him laughing. And he's like, well, you're kidding me, Gato? Like, it's got to be a joke. Like, you're telling me Ghetto's going to win? Like, no. And he's like doing one of those, like, man, I love Gato or whatever, but this has got to be a total joke. So he has this new shirt with his Gato, the Rain Taker. It's glorious.
That was pretty funny, yeah.
So, you know, he is and then in this match, you know, he basically does ghetto things, which if you've never watched Ghetto, he basically does all those heel things that you used to do back in the day. You know, the eye gouge, the face twist, the, you know, all those dastardly things that heels used to do, that really got to the mega heat or whatever. Ghetto does that stuff. So, I mean, like, Ghetto gets a replay for basically elbowing the rope, like, going into the ropes and crotching Bushi in the turnbuckle, which I thought was hilarious. Like, he's getting a replay for that. Like, just, you know, and he goes and hits Bushi with a ring bell, and Bushi goes and chokes him with a chair. I mean, it's just Bushi laying down and grabbing his face like, oh, you're nothing, Ghetto. Like, what's this, you know? And it's just, then Ghetto hits that Rainmaker Haymaker and pins him. And it's like, holy crap, he just beat Bushi. Like, just, wow. I thought he'd lose to Taguchi, like, right before that final day or whatever, but maybe this is, like, the kind of the putting him behind the eight ball thing from the beginning, and who knows. But I don't know. After we got done with this night, man, I'm really starting to questioning that maybe Paul was right in his pick, and I'm totally wrong. But what'd you guys think?
First off, Bushi is my pick to win.
Yeah,
and he still
too.
Is. Yeah. I somehow think I was looking at the lineup for the rest, and I'm really thinking that final day is not the final day, the next to last day, it's just all junior matches. There's no tagged with the heavies or anything. But I'm thinking we're gonna get some kind of a playoff situation, you know, where a couple guys are tied. So before that, you're going to probably see some surprises, and this was one of them. But how cool was it when Bushi came out, there was that whole section of fans with Bushi masks on and, you know, the LIJ shirts and stuff. And it was on the other side of the ring from where he came out, and he actually walked around, stood in front of them and acknowledged them, and then walked back around to his side of the ring, got in the ring. I thought that was so cool. And the Ghetto being Ghetto, the great Southern heel, the guy he's fun to watch because, you know, you're not going to take him seriously as a main eventer, but he's just so entertaining. And me and my buddy were joking, yeah, he got 2-0 last year. No way he's winning here. They got the pin, and we just looked at each other, you know, like wide-eyed, like, we didn't say a word. We just looked at each other. We couldn't speak, and it was, like, awesome. You know, we both then we popped. Yeah, it was like, Ghetto won. You know, we love Ghetto, but we weren't expecting him to win. You know, we're probably like Okada sitting at the table. Yeah, he's not going to beat him.
But, oh, yeah, you know. Okada is the greatest cheerleader. Like, he's totally joking about his friend, but then he's getting into the mats, too, and he's like, oh, my God, Ghetto won. Whatever.
You know, I love Ghetto too, and I think this is the one time a year where he can show up and do everything that he can to get these guys over, directly. So he certainly puts on the best performances possible during this time of year. He showed it last year. I think he's going to do it again this year. This was surprising. I thought Bushi was going to get this one with, some mist and some shenanigans, but, Ghetto says no. War Ghetto killed him, with that Haymaker. And, God, I'm super nervous. I picked Ospreay to win, but I had Bushi keeping it close all the way to the end in the B block, or in the A block, excuse me. So now I'm my pick-ems are making me look like I don't know anything about New Japan, and I'm feeling really bad about myself.
Well, you know, who knows? Maybe he goes on a run after this. I think it's fine. You know, there's a little feud going here, so. It makes Ghetto where you have to take him seriously now,
mm-hmm.
because, you know, again, the joke before this is that he loses all the time. So you have to take him seriously, and people are already in his matches. Like, they were cheering for him already, you know, and so it gives you more reason to pay attention when he does this, because he does this stuff, you know. We'll see if he goes on a little mini run again, or it's just this one time. But you know, he could beat Finley or not beat Finley. I guess it wouldn't necessarily matter. I could see him beating like Taguchi or something too. But speaking of Taguchi, so we get Ryusuke Taguchi against Matt Sydal after this, and Taguchi, I don't know what this is, if there's some kind of deal with Sesame Street or what it is, or he has some kind of deal with some kind of chicken thing or whatever, but now he comes out to some kind of, like, it's obviously some copyrighted, like, bird thing or whatever, some weird ass music.
It came out was an inflated Big Bird on his head.
Yes. And has a recorder that makes it look like he is inflating the Big Bird as he is walking, which is totally, utterly ridiculous. But, you know, it works for Taguchi. You know, we're used to him being just this hilarious guy. And so, I mean, look, and to be credit to the guy, he sells shirts now that he never would have sold previously. He's just bland Taguchi. So, you know, he's been doing that Nakamura tribute thing for a while. I mean, so, you know, it just, I got to give him credit for showing personality. It may not always be the best thing that he does in matches, but to be fair, just like Ghetto, when it's time for the best of Super Juniors, this guy brings it. You know, and he did some hip attack stuff, but he went away from that here. He was working on, or really it was Sydal working on his leg, and he sort of is working on Sydal, but there's a point where Sydal goes for a kick, Taguchi goes to block it, does a dragon screw, Sydal goes to slap down, and he slaps down on Taguchi's eye, and it busts his eye open. He's bleeding from the side of his eye. And sort of like after that, Taguchi gets really pissed. So it's sort of like, it almost like it played into the match really well. He really goes into the ankle lock and everything. And then he goes, hits two Dodons and freaking wins. I really enjoyed this great match. The close to this was really well done too.
Yeah, you're remembering all the spots. I'm trying to remember them all. I remember the blood, how that happened and all. But the thing I remember, it's just besides him coming out with a Big Bird on his head, it turned into a really, not just because of the blood enhanced it, but it turned into a really intense match down the stretch. And it was just, like you said, Taguchi in the junior tournament, he brings it. You know, and all of a sudden becomes like a, still does some of his antics, but he becomes more of a serious guy. You know, it's just that one time a year. And it was a semi-main event, and he wrestled like a semi-main eventer, and it was a really good match. And once again, another surprise. I mean, you would think that all wins, but here we are, 3-for-3, and, you know, fun matches, really good matches.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had Sydal going pretty deep in this tournament, too. And then this happens, and once again, I look like a chump, but, you know, Taguchi here, I'm going to give him props, because I think the blood spot sort of changed it. Like, he was working what he normally did, and I'm assuming, you know, the quick serious change was going to come about as you went down the stretch, but I think the blood spot totally changed that for him, and is a nice little about face for him, because he was almost watching a whole new wrestler whenever the blood spot happened, so... And you know, props to Sydal too. He's one of the best high flyers in the game right now, and he's super good. Absolutely deserves this opportunity too. So, hats off to both these guys. They put on one heck of a match.
Well,
I believe I think Sydal signed a regular New Japan contract too, if I'm not mistaken.
I hope so. He really deserves. He's so good.
Yeah, he's so good. He deserves to have more of these singles matches. I think it was only his second one. This year, he deserves to have more of them. I think the junior title match that he had with Omega. Speaking of the junior champion having a rematch of the final on the first night, so this is like when you have the Super Bowl and then you wait until the next season, and you know that you have your biggest rival that first week of the season. This is Kyle O'Reilly. He's been waiting that entire time here for Kushida to show back up. He knows. He saw the blocks. He knows he's facing Kushida. And this is Kyle O'Reilly going out there, and he wanted to make sure that not only did he stand out, but he was making sure Kushida was not going to beat him again. And he worked on that leg. I thought the spot where Kushida cartwheels out of the armbar the first time is very key, because it plays into the finish where he's worked on that leg so much, there's no way Kushida's going to be able to use his legs to get out of the match, get out of the triangle and the armbar later. But so many spots. These guys are so good together. Like, when you talk about guys that just have mega chemistry, you talk about having your dance partner that you're going to have that match with every time that they get together. That's Kushida and Kyle O'Reilly. And Kyle O'Reilly is only a couple of pounds smaller than Shibata. So, honestly, he could have a heavyweight run if New Japan is cool with that. If you're going to talk about weight and all that stuff. And obviously, you know, Kushida wants to do that going to the G1 and everything. So, would be pretty cool to see him get to do that at some point. But what did you guys think?
I like the analogy of the rematch from the Super Bowl. So it's the rematch from last year. And it was even bigger, I thought, because that match from last year just aired on Access maybe a couple weeks ago or something. And so it's now fresh again, and everybody's talking about it again, and you're saying, how could they top that? And I don't think it topped it, but this match was pretty damn great. You're talking about the armbar spots. Kushida has a, I wouldn't call it a pattern now, but he has a system where his match is going to just concentrate on the submission, the armbar spot, and he's just going to build the counters and the escapes and everything he does around that. And he just, the guy is so brilliant. And, you know, he just did that interview where he said Kyle O'Reilly, the best wrestler in the world. So this is going to be an exciting series, I think. I hope they don't do it like every other tour, make it once or twice a year, to keep it special, like Dynamite Kid and Tiger Mask way back in the 80s. And every match will mean something then.
Since their big clash in the final of the Best of the Super Junior last year, they've only wrestled four more times, including this one. They had a match together in Rev Pro over in England. They did one for the last tour here, Ring of Honor in New Japan. And then they have this one here. And you're right. They have absolutely incredible chemistry together. The spot where Kyle O'Reilly runs off the apron, Kushida leaps out of the chair he's sitting in to catch him in the armbar, might be spot of the year. It is absolutely incredible. There's GIFs everywhere of it online. I totally recommend you go find those if you don't want to watch the match. It's incredible. This entire match is incredible. It's certainly a match of the year candidate. And I thought Kyle O'Reilly was going to win here. They're going to build challengers by Kushida losing to certain people during this one. And this is one of them for sure. So, hats off to both these guys, because they got it, you know.
And you mentioned the Rev Pro match. My buddy and I watched that match right after watching this one. And if anybody has access to it, I suggest watching it. That match was incredible.
Rev Pro has a deal up on Pivot Share where you can watch their shows for a certain cost. I can't remember what it is off the top of my head, but you can certainly follow them there.
I downloaded the match.
Mm-hmm.
Through a less than reputable site, but anyway.
No shame in that game, man.
Yeah, I'm going to try to put it up on the group page when I get a chance. It's really, it needs to be seen.
Yeah, I mean, no, I totally agree. Just, I've been thinking about, I don't know if I can do both. I'm sitting here like three between, you know, people keep telling me I need to go watch, which I've watched a bunch of it. I just, for $5, I feel like the Stardom World thing is too good to pass up. And then you've got between Progress and Rev Pro. It's like, well, I don't know if I have another $8 to put somewhere. But like I'm just, I keep saying, okay, I'm gonna watch this, and I don't know, it might be pretty soon just to watch that match and some other stuff to be able to subscribe to that. But man, this match is fantastic. Match of your contender. I think the first one from last year's the final was a little bit better. But I mean, we're talking about picking hairs here. So I think wonderful. Like, I know technically the ROH match happened first, so we're going to see it last. If this is the last time these two wrestle for a while, wonderful conclusion to what's been a really good a great series between these two. And hopefully, you know, we see more of it. So that's the end of night one. Night two, already up there on New Japan World. Night three, we'll cover that tomorrow as well on our Monday night edition, where we'll also be covering Raw. I know people are probably expecting that we talk about the Cody Rhodes thing. We're going to hold off. We always like to have these. I know we haven't always done it in the past, but I like having these pay-per-view things kind of be able to stand on their own and not necessarily have big things that people go, oh, that happened then too. Well, we have another show the next day. It can wait one more day. We'll have plenty of time to talk about the Cody Rhodes thing and whatever else has been going on in wrestling on the Monday night show. Gary, you there?
Yeah, I'm here. Okay. I appreciate you mentioning that, Sean. Yeah, if you want to go check that show out tomorrow night, make sure you go check us out on the W2M Network. It is Wrestling to the Max. It is our Monday edition. We'll be talking Cody Rhodes and all that stuff that's going down with him, plus some other big news. Of course, we'll be getting into that Raw. It'll be the fallout of Extreme Rules. So we've got a lot of great stuff coming your way, plus all the great stuff Sean already mentioned to you. And, of course, hey, we're just going to throw a few things out there. Make sure you go rate and review us. We appreciate everybody who checks us out on these pay-per-view shows. I'm assuming a lot of you are listening on the download on Monday, so that is great. Make sure you always look us up. I mean, if you're watching a pay-per-view, we'll always be here covering it, talking about it, and really breaking things down for you. Besides that...
And also, it's good to listen to those, because this is kind of a lot of people in one thing, and you don't really get to understand what the podcast is about when you have these. These are kind of just special standalone things for the pay-per-views. And, you know, if you listen to the Monday show or the Thursday show, you kind of get more of what the podcast is about and kind of just get the three of us talking about things and whatever. So if it's your first time listening, apologize if it got a little bit long in the tooth on Extreme Rules with all the callers or whatever, but we don't really have callers on the regular shows. So a lot more fluid and less issues.
Yeah, for sure. And saying that, the reason this show does have so much of that is because it is a pay-per-view. Otherwise, you know, like Sean said, it's not so heavy, not so many people. But we definitely appreciate everybody that's on the show tonight. And of course, you know, we got to give a shout-out to Patrick Ketza, Harry Broadhurst for joining us, you know, like always. And of course, hey, you know, thanks for Tom, man. We really appreciate you coming on here and hanging with us tonight, man.
Appreciate it.
So
2016, man, how many match of the year candidates have we talked about already?
Jeez,
we're only not even halfway through this. It's been a great year, and there's just so much happening.
Yeah, Paul, I mean, you're keeping your list. I mean, your list has got to be pretty long.
Yeah, let me grab a count here real fast.
This may take about 10 minutes. I'm kidding. It's because, I mean, the list is very long. It really is. You're right on that, Tom. You know, it's been amazing. It's good. I mean, this is a good problem to have already. I think it's excellent. You know, we're not even halfway through the year.
41 is what my list is at. And that's just with the stuff we cover. That's not including everything else that's going on.
Yeah.
Wow.
It really, really is. But hey, that's good. That's a good thing once again. So, but you know, guys, we have been on for a little while, and I'm sure people are ready for us to sign off here. So we just want to throw a shout out to the W2M Network. Make sure you go check out everything on there. Go subscribe if you're not subscribed already. That'll get you not only W2M, but a lot of other great shows like Wrestling Unwrapped and also video games to the max, plus, of course, football to the max. And, you know, you also have the other shows like TWNE After Dark. Great shows. We also have some other wrestling programs on there as well. Go check them all out. Everything on the network is great. You don't want to miss any of it, so... Well, guys, we are out of here. Just one last thing. We want you to always remember one thing. If you're not living life to the max.
Not living life at all.
You know it.
Peace.